everybody. Welcome to the Select Board meeting of May 11th. Calling the meeting to order at 7 o'clock. And first on the list is the consent agenda. And tonight on the consent agenda, we have minutes from April 6th and May 4th. We have payroll warrants 1645 and 46, and accounts payable 45 and 46. Then we also have some language about dealing with consent warrants for the months of June through August. I think it was brought up at the last meeting that sometimes in the summer we run into some difficulty getting signatures in a timely manner. So people were wondering if they would be willing to accept during that time frame, provide authorization to the treasurer and the accountant to process weekly warrants when the select board does not meet. And the board will designate an official to sign on behalf of the board. So those are the consent items.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion on the consent?
Like to appoint either David Nixon or Molly Keegan if you're in town, or if we could have alternates.
We've coordinated our schedule through August, and it looks like one or the other is going to be
should
in town.
Be here. That should work.
And I'd also like to add the provision that if we're in a situation where one official signs the warrant, that the warrant be presented back to the board mm-hmm. at their next meeting for their review.
Right. Agreeable to that?
So moved.
Okay.
Sorry. Yes.
You specifically said June through August. I know we actually have an issue for this.
It'd be from effective immediately.
Okay.
So right. I'm
okay.
going to be asking them to sign a letter to that effect.
Okay, so okay. we can start sooner.
All right, so the motion is actually from this time forward through the end of August.
Yeah. Correct.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, so there's a motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Hang on, I'm just getting to it now. Yeah, aye.
Thank you.
Okay.
No, there was nothing. I just want to make sure there was nothing on for.
Yeah, nothing for
DPW.
Okay. All right, excellent. Then with that, we'll move into the public comment period. We've allowed, every meeting we allow 15 minutes for public comment. Is there anyone here this evening who would like to make public comment?
I would like to make a comment, please.
Sure.
We did our Hadley cleanup last week, but we ran into a rainstorm, so we only had about a dozen people show, but the people that did show were very good workers. We took care of all of the town property, including the part of the bikeway in the center of town, all the schools, the town common. Zaterka Park was cleaned. Silvio Conti Trail was cleaned. Most of Route 47 and Bay Road. And I would like to thank the highway superintendent for coming from Greenfield with his son to participate. It was a real nice gesture of you to do that. And but we're gonna do it again this Saturday. Hopefully the weather is better. I've contacted some youth groups so they can get community service awards like Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts, and we're gonna attempt to do the rest.
Excellent. And do you wanna just notify people of the time and location again, Donald?
It's the same, it's 9:30 to 12. We're gonna meet at Hopkins Academy, and we'll have a little light breakfast, assign our areas and work, and then come back to Hopkins and we'll have a little light lunch too.
Okay, so good effort there. So hopefully the weather will be a little bit more cooperative this Saturday for those who are able to participate. Any other public comment? Mr. Michkowski?
Yeah. Seeing this is after town meeting, infrastructure.
Mm-hmm.
Are you planning to put an article on for the fall town meeting for an override? Because if not, I'm going to start, circulating a petition in the amount of $2 million for water, sewer, and drainage.
Okay.
Okay. So one of the things that's going to be talked about tonight is the ramp up for the fall town meeting when the tri-board is here. I've taken it upon myself to put together a draft warrant for this fall town meeting. On that warrant, there's a placeholder for capital projects. So I don't spell anything out, but there is a capital projects place.
I certainly want the opportunity to petition this if this board refuses to take any action. Okay.
You should have that opportunity. And the other thing I would add to, in the tri-board meeting this evening that starts at 7:15, we're going to be discussing kind of a an outline of how to arrive at a strategic plan leading up to Fall Town Meeting as well. And you'll hear some discussion about some of the information that we need or, you know,
request.
Again, we're going to be requesting to that end. So I think right now it would be premature to respond yes or no to the specific question you asked, but we're certainly going to be moving, you know, along the lines
I've
of that.
I've been asking this for a long time now.
Sure. And also we're going to, as you know, tonight, the DPW director is also on a scheduled appointment at 7:45.
Another thing I want to look into is like the loam and clean fill to see if we can roster on all these development projects somewhere that the town can store it, because if the town moves ahead with that fire station by North Hadley Hall, it could use all free fill to fill that right up so it'd be level with the street, not down in a ditch. And I don't know if it's allowed on the, I was gonna call Charlie Klein, the DEP, on the dump site to store, you know, a big mound there. And also, I think that like loam, surplus loam, would be good for the guys like the farmer that does the potting, the nurseries, and stuff like that to replenish the land bank that they take away. So I'd like to see that happen.
So is that a request, John?
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
I guess that leads me to a question about the same thing. Do we have surplus loam area at the DPW anywhere?
We have a surplus area. We have some gravel there, some actual fill, and there is some loam already. It's pretty recongested with.
How many yards?
I haven't estimated it, John. We have a pretty good pile back there, but I can get you that information.
And again, because we're in public comment, we just want to be careful not to have too much discussion about a topic.
Right.
But certainly, yeah. We've recorded it as a request.
When are you going to update the sewer regs and the water regulations? You guys are water and sewer commissioners,
mm-hmm.
And I know those sewer regs, we only did this much in it, and the rest is, it's gonna be gone right through from beginning to end if they need updating.
Mm-hmm.
I imagine the water too, that I never heard any updates with that.
Okay, I don't have an answer for you on that right now, but again, I'll record it as a request.
And at the town meeting, there was $100,000 error or mistake I didn't quite understand. Who was responsible for that? That kind of looked kind of messy in front of town meeting there.
You're talking about the on the sewer?
No,
the,
I don't know what it
the
was.
The sewer line item?
Just,
is that
Brian West picked something up.
Yeah.
None of you guys.
So the issue there was that we had the correct amount in the sewer line item for both salaries and expenses. In the debt and interest line, there was no amount listed because it was included in the expense line. Brian raised a question about whether we would be in compliance with our borrowing requirements. So on the spur of the moment and in an abundance of caution, so that we would not find ourselves in technical non-compliance with debt payment, we amended the motion in order to make sure that there was debt and interest money in that line item. So we were able to correct the issue. We will follow up at the Fall Town Meeting in order to make any further adjustments to that.
The money
was there, it just needed to be repositioned.
Did the Finance Committee overlook that, or was it you that overlooked it? Who overlooked that?
Well, I'm the town administrator, so if you're looking for somebody to blame me.
I think
I'm not
were,
looking for somebody
yeah.
to blame, I just wanted to ask.
To be
know.
Fair, there were actually several sets of eyes that looked at that report. And it was just human error. But again, the bottom line was accurate, so we're good.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay. Any further public comment? Okay. If not, just because we have a couple of minutes, I would just like to follow up on last week. We started a process where there are basically action items coming out of the select board meeting. And Jennifer's graciously records that to make sure that we follow-up. So there were, I believe, four action items from last week's meeting. One of them was the select board had requested that they receive an electronic copy of some sample codes of conduct, and that was mailed out after the meeting. There was another question about committee appointments for the Hadley Select Board, whether or not there was a policy. And there actually is not a policy in place, and at some point when we are addressing possible revisions to our own policies, that's something that we could consider as a board, whether or not we want to do that. Right now, the Select Board really, by law, has very broad powers in committee appointments, so we can have more conversation about that. There were actually several questions related, as we all recall, to the North Hadley Village Hall RFP process. And that is on our agenda this evening, so we'll have more information on that. And, oh, and the one other question that came up had to do with HPAT, what the record retention policy was. And Jennifer was able to find, this was from the April 15th meeting of, do you know what year? 2015, okay, so a year ago, the HPAT record retention policy was voted, and it reads that the policy has been previously been to keep records for 2 years, and the state only mandates 6 months, so the town of Hadley was actually exceeding the state requirement for the amount of time. However, the town administrator did ask our HPAT director to keep permanent records, and the board agreed with Mr. Nixon's recommendation, and that's what was voted a year ago. So just wanted to close the loop on that request. Okay. So we'll be doing this on a regular basis, so I'm sure there will be action items coming up tonight. Okay. I think we're close enough to our 7:15 appointment. All right. Close enough?
Okay. Will the administrator's report just take a couple minutes?
Will that allow you enough time, David?
Let me rush through the cliff notes then.
Well, I'd rather you didn't rush.
All right.
So.
What your board's pleasure?
What's my pleasure? What's your pleasure?
Okay.
You okay, please?
15 points.
Okay. All right. So our 7:15 appointment is with the Tri Board. So tonight we have some representation from the school committee. Hi, Linda.
Hi. What's that gold thing?
Oh, that's Calvin.
Oh, thank you.
It's Hadley. I couldn't find a gavel. I thought,
okay,
why not? Haven't had to use it yet. So for the Tri Board meeting, it does not appear actually that we have any members of the Finance Committee here yet.
Not yet.
Why don't we do?
I'm sorry, I didn't realize that when I started going down this merry path. All right. So, Linda, you okay sitting tight for five? Okay. How about we move into the town administrator's report?
Thank you very much. So you have this in front of you, so I won't go over it line by line, but I do want to touch on a couple of things that we've been working on. The first one is in the nature of projects. We have an update on the Bay Road Bridge project. MassDOT held an evaluation of the wood support structures of the bridge yesterday. Based upon their observations, the problems are a little bit more extensive than they had expected, so they have to revise the scope of work and the design and the funding, and these estimates are being developed. Construction is still estimated to occur in July and August, with completion date of around Labor Day. So Route 9 widening, utility work is progressive. We have a utility meeting coming up on next Tuesday.
8 a.m.
Right. The contractor has established their office at the Russell School building. They've occupied the town-owned parking lot adjacent to the American Legion. We're working with the American Legion and the contractor in order to make sure that we have an amicable agreement that accommodates the events of the Legion and certainly the Memorial Day parade coming up. Let's see, a lot of survey work going on, and we have submitted our SRF funding application. We expect an answer from DEP within 35 days. thanks to Senator Rosenberg for the opportunity to secure funding through the SRF program, which will save the ratepayers money in the long run. Public Safety Complex HVAC control project. This project is outbid with a due date of June 6th. Public Safety Complex rules roof. The specifications are completed. Project is ready to go out to bid except for the final funding piece. And the select board are scheduled to set a ballot date for that final piece at tonight's meeting. Owner's project manager, the town meeting approved the funding, so the qualifications from 7 outfits have been sent out to the evaluation team. And I've asked the evaluation team to come back with their ranking on June 1st so that we can select a finalist at that point. IT upgrade, Northeast IT, our vendor, thank you very much, Linda, has issued work tickets for the IT upgrades at Town Hall. The work is expected to commence as soon as a part arrives. This project should help boost internet capabilities and overall productivity of the offices here. Wage and classification study, the statistical work on the data gathered from comparable communities is proceeding. We're being assisted by Ms. Maura Shea, an intern from the University of Massachusetts. Commonwealth Compact, we were awarded 2 technical support grants for 1, a development of a financial management team, and 2, Safe Routes to School project. There was a signing ceremony back in February. We received in March a letter from the Department of Revenue saying that they would be in touch with us in the next couple of months to get the project moving. I reached out to them to see if we can't accelerate this because this is, both these projects are important to the town and we want to get them up and going as soon as possible. We've heard a presentation on electricity aggregation. We've submitted the service agreement to council for review. I expect to be able to bring this back to the board in the next week or two. Departmental functions borrowing. The treasurer has been working with our chief financial advisor, David Eisenthal of Union Bank, as well as our bond council in order to set up borrowing for a number of already approved projects. And the select board is scheduled to meet with Mr. Eisenthal on June 1st in order to proceed with that borrowing. Our revenues, the department heads have been asked to look at our revenue streams. I've asked in particular to make sure that the fees that they're charging are covering the municipal services that we are incurring, that the expenses for issuance and administration fees should be in place to cover municipal services provided to selected populations rather than the general population. So I've asked for that review. And I want to make sure that our practices are in place in order to make sure that we're following through capturing the fees that we're charging. We've put a placeholder article on the draft special town meeting warrant in order to make any adjustments that may be necessary. In addition, I was able to get the April revenues from Linda today, and I've prepared a report for you. They look very good and very promising for the end of the fiscal year. Expenses, all the department heads have been asked to watch their spending in the final 2 months of the fiscal year, and they've received specific instructions about how to handle encumbrances and other kinds of expenses. Any encumbrance over $200 has to be approved by me, whose permission will not be unreasonably withheld. End of the fiscal year, we have a new team in place. The last department head meeting, we talked about specific deadlines for submittal of revenues, which would be June 30th at noon to Linda. Submittal of 2016 expenses, and that's July 27th at noon, and I'll be asking the select board later on to set a last warrant for FY16. As well as instructions on how to process the payroll as the week straddles the fiscal year. The Finance Committee is going to be alerted, I guess I'm alerting you now, about your deadline for adjusting the FY16 budgets, either through reserve fund transfer or the line-to-line transfers. That would be July 15th would be the absolute deadline on that. Any encumbrances from FY16 not used are going to be closed out to free cash so we can reduce the number of stray line items that are out there. Collective bargaining units, we've approved three collective bargaining units by town meeting, and we're now processing the retroactive pay, the new pay rates, and all the other provisions that are negotiated. Keeping an open communication with the collective bargaining units in order to make sure that everybody understands what we're trying to do and to avoid problems with implementation. I understand that the union personnel have been very patient in waiting for their retroactive pay and their new pay rates, and I appreciate their patience on this. Implementation of town meeting votes. Voters approved a number of projects, initiatives, and department heads are working on that implementation. This includes the Turka Park, the solar field pilot agreement, as well as the tiny house enforcement. And I was working with the building inspector this afternoon in order to make sure that that enforcement is communicated to the occupant of the house as well as followed through by that town department so that enforcement will be effective. I'm asking that the select board schedule a ballot vote on the two debt exclusion votes approved by town meeting. When we get into our tri-board meeting, we'll be talking about that. Upcoming projects and events. The first one is the issuance of the MS4 stormwater permit. This is something that we've known has been coming for years. A lot of towns have been pushing back with this issue, but it's finally here. Mr. Warner and I attended a training session on the requirements of the newly issued U.S. Environmental Protection Agency's MS4 stormwater permit, which takes effect on July 1, 2017, so that's two Julys from now. In a nutshell, US EPA is working through the Massachusetts Department of Environmental Protection, requiring many communities in the Connecticut River Basin, including Hadley, to perform a series of investigations into stormwater systems and stormwater treatment in order to reduce contaminants entering the Connecticut River and its tributaries, in an effort ultimately to try to clean up Long Island Sound. The program will unfold over a 10-year period once the project becomes active. We're working on placing programs and initiatives in place to minimize the impact of this federal unfunded mandate. And we've been working with the Building Department Conservation Planning Board on articles for the special town meeting to help to reduce the burden of the permit requirements. I think it's fair to say that we have many more questions on this permit than we have answers, but we know that it's going to be a long project, and it's going to be expensive, and we're going to try to do whatever we can to mitigate its impact on the town of Hadley. Special town meeting. I'm asking for a special town meeting to be scheduled for October 27th. Part of your tri-board meeting tonight includes a countdown schedule of deadlines and action items for that town meeting. Lake Warner Dam, we have Kestrel Trust here today to talk about the Lake Warner Dam. But just a couple of side notes. Representative Sybeck was able to secure the state funding in the amount of $125,000. I know that there was some concern about a deadline coming up on that. And the state was further able to determine that the project is exempt from Massachusetts procurement laws. So a number of obstacles have been lifted to make this project move forward. We have a sunset provision in the CPA article funding this project, and I've placed an article on this draft warrant for the special town meeting in order to extend that deadline. And then finally, Memorial Day Parade. It is on May 29th, 2 p.m. at American Legion. I hope everybody comes out to honor the veterans.
Anybody on the board have any questions or comments for the town administrator?
Yeah, mm-hmm. I do. Why isn't the board petitioning the EPA and the DEP to prolong this until they come up with some grant money or some funding along with these regulations?
Would you like us to?
I think we should.
Okay.
We don't even have any idea what this is going to cost us.
Are you aware of any...
And I'm sure there's a lot of other towns that are interested in doing it, too.
That's what I was just going to ask. David, are you aware of any other initiatives underway to petition McGovern or anybody about this?
Yeah, so, I mean, this has been a slow-moving train wreck for quite some time, and we've been pushing back as much as possible. I know the Regional Planning Agency's been involved in this. It is something that has finally arrived. We will continue to protest loudly and often to anybody who will listen that this is an onerous, unfunded mandate that needs to be lifted from the shoulders of particularly small towns. The one grant money that the DEP was talking about is money to the coalition, and I think we're a member of that, but I'm going to follow up with Pioneer Valley Planning Commission to make sure that we're a member of that coalition, and if there's any kind of money that might be available in the form of technical assistance that we're able to do this.
Does anybody else have an appetite for taking a formal stand on this? And
what types of things are they asking the town to do?
We have to do an extensive investigation into our drainage systems, and drainage is loosely defined in any swale, any pipe, any outfall that enters into a body of water. And I don't think this covers the entire town. It's mainly the Route 9 corridor, so Lake Warner is not part of this at this time. But any drainage that falls into a public water, into a water system, needs to be investigated, needs to be tested for contaminants, and they're looking for nitrogen, phosphorus, chloride, oil and grease, solids, bacteria, pathogens, a couple of others that I can't remember. If there are positive hits, and you know that there will be, we have to investigate back upstream the sources and look for illicit connections to the stormwater system, that, say, a sewage pipe that's connected to the stormwater system. We don't think that there are any municipal sewage pipes, but there might be private sewage pipes connected to the stormwater system. Those have to be remediated. There's further testing that needs to happen. Treatment of stormwater outfall that exceeds the minimums, and we don't know what those are. And then there's annual reporting that's required. So I think this gets expensive in year 4 and 5.
Mm-hmm. Yay, State. Yeah.
So, I mean, I agree with John, and I think that there's nothing wrong. I think it can only help to have...
You know, this is public and private. This is all the land in the town of Hadley. This is not just the municipal pipes. And yeah. Are the state going to be responsible for their pipes that are underground that lead to the river? Because yeah. They've got the major corridor that mm-hmm. has most of the oil and grease along Route 9. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a lot of questions that need to be answered before they implement this on these towns.
Can we put it on as a future agenda item to discuss
language? Yes, we'll be talking about this for a long time.
But I mean specifically mm-hmm. about whether or not the board should, you know, petition the legislature.
Absolutely, I recommend doing it.
Okay.
And, you know, talk to the legislatures and see where they're at with this.
Okay.
It's just you know, with our financial burden we have in this town right now, never mind all the other towns across the country, you know, this is a federal mandate that somebody signed their name to.
Yeah.
It was with the pork bellies, and we're not getting the pork bellies either, so.
Maybe we should get Senator McGovern.
Well, that's, I think he'd be the receiving end of it, yeah.
It's a federal.
It's a federal.
Yeah. What else?
Any other questions for Dave?
Did you get anything else out of the meeting, Marlo, or not?
Well, basically what I got out of it, to sum it up, is mostly everything that needs to be done in what they're calling the Phase 2 MS4. There was a lot of pushback the last 7 or 8 years. That's what took so long for the permit to come out. It lulled everybody to sleep. Well, it's coming out next year. So now that it's come out, they're basically saying this is it. They made some changes. They backed off on a few of the minor things as far as marking outfalls and stuff like that, permanently marking them. But the expensive part of this is the engineering. You know, you have to do so many samples when it's pouring rain. You have to do so many samples when it's been so many dry days. I mean, to follow this thing and to meet a 31-page permit, it's very extensive, and to say, you know, you could do some of this in-house, that would probably be very difficult at this point. I haven't read the whole permit, but I totally agree with everything I'm hearing here. I mean, it's an unfunded mandate. It's going to be very expensive. Small examples, they want to put the sweepings part of the new permit, that you're going to want us to sweep the roads twice a year, which we've made the adjustments to get away from the sweeping and the sand that fill the basin. So there's a couple of things that the town of Hadley's already taken steps towards the previous permit. Now they've ramped it back the other way. So I certainly disagree with a lot of what's going on in this permit. I'm not sure. I did have an email from CEI. We've been talking back and forth on this issue before it came out. And DEP is trying to take control of DEP is trying to take control from EPA on administering this. Believe it or not, the emails that I were reading was the DEP was actually supporting the communities and trying to push back on this whole thing. And they only got as far as they got. But they are trying to take control on helping municipalities and so on and so forth. I went to a few workshops before I was hired here. They were labeled as, how to fund these things. And basically, to this point, all we're hearing is taxation, SRF,
yeah.
And obviously an added tax, a stormwater
runoff,
yeah. Whatever, utility.
You know, and they're really going to be kicking themselves in the butt down the line here, because that article that I had sent you and the board members about the $1.3 billion, that the legislature is supposed to release for water and for sewer specifically. They're going to tap that money if there's enough of pushback, and then the infrastructure is going to be hurting it. So, unless you go after them fairly strong, I think they're going to implement this, and it's going to cost the taxpayers a ton of money down the road here.
So we'll put it on a separate agenda item at a future point in time.
Sure.
Okay. Very quickly, any other questions for the town administrator about his report, and then we'll move into the tri-board now that we have all three committees represented.
Good initial.
No. Okay. And David, will your report be posted with the meeting material?
I'm on you. I did this week. I can do it again. So.
Yeah. Oh, no. Just letting people know.
In the minutes.
Yes.
Yeah, it's part of it. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Molly?
Thank you.
No.
Pardon, Jen.
How's that? That stormwater that affect the planning board. I know we deal with the plans, but it's all sent to Marlowe for a total review. Because while Route 9, all that works its way into the Fort River and dumps into the Connecticut River. So you're going to go through every plan, right?
Yes, all that's going to be part of the permit. There's so much, it's 31 pages. I mean, it certainly is a different agenda for. There's a lot to talk about with this this whole issue here.
With respect to the planning board, I think planning board, building, conservation, and town administration need to work cooperatively on an article for either the fall town meeting or an annual town meeting at the latest. In particular, we want to make sure that our regulations are developed in such a way that runoff from any development or any redevelopment of a parcel does not enter into the stormwater collection system. Once the water gets into the stormwater collection, we own it, and all the consequences of what that may mean. If we can make sure that our regulations are set up in order to minimize the amount of stormwater from new construction or redevelopment entering into the stormwater system, that will relieve the burden on the taxpayers.
It's like the Route 9 corridor, too. The state dumps all that salt, runs down.
Okay. Yep.
Who's going to take care of that?
Okay, there are clearly a lot of questions on it. So, but at this point, we're late now for our tri-board meeting. So now that we have representation from all three committees, can we move to that scheduled appointment? David, do you want to kick it off?
Do I want to kick it off? Okay, so thank you all for taking the time to meet. I guess the first thing is that we have the annual town meeting. We need to schedule the debt exclusion ballot vote for the both the backhoe and the public safety complex roof. We have an absolute drop dead deadline of September 15th for such a ballot on an annual town meeting. The clerk needs 35 days to register voters. So I guess the main question is, do you want to schedule this vote quickly, or do you want to move on to after the summer is over?
I'd like to do it as quickly as we possibly could.
I think we did it last year right off the bat. Right away.
To do it sooner rather than later?
Yeah.
Okay.
Finance committee agree with that? To do
yes.
The...
I
you are the finance committee.
Yeah.
Okay. And Linda, you don't have any...
Just
you don't have a horse
a
in this
idea.
Race. All right. Yeah. So.
All right. So the only thing to be aware of is that the town clerk does not have a budget for another election in this fiscal year, so
we'd be looking to a reserve fund transfer?
Something like that.
Or she needs 35 days from our discussion today. Today is the 10th, so you're really not that far out.
Right, so the earliest you could schedule it would be?
First week in
June
July.
16th?
Which would make the
yeah.
Last day of school?
That's
the last
reserve
day of school
transfer.
Is the 21st?
Yeah.
I got no horse in that race either, so I don't remember.
Okay. Sounds good.
Is that right?
Excellent.
Chief?
Sure.
Something around then, right?
Yeah.
I'll make a motion to do it 35 days between, what'd you say, June 16th?
So June 16th would be the 35th day.
Mm-hmm. And
make
that's
a
reserve,
Thursday.
And ask for a reserve fund transfer.
Okay.
To cover that.
Because we'll want to coordinate with the school's schedule.
Mm-hmm.
Right, Linda?
And with Jessica's.
Yeah. So maybe for a motion, could we ask, you know,
on or
propose,
about?
Yeah, on or about, and then let Jessica work it out with the David and the school.
Okay, so the motion is to set a date of the 16th or 35 days thereafter. The polling hours would be 12 to 8,
mm-hmm.
And the ballot questions are set by law for the backhoe and for the public safety complex roof project.
Second.
Any further discussion on that?
I think it's a good date because if we wait any longer, we're going to entertain vacation time.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to remember the last override vote only brought out 8%, 342 people.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we have to do something else to advertise it better or something, you know, to let people know that this vote is being taken,
mm-hmm.
so we have a much better turnout.
Yep, agreed.
Okay, so sounds like a motion and a vote.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Finance committee, and this is tri-board, so, yeah?
Gotcha.
Okay, all right. It's unanimous.
All right.
And is that also along with the request for a finance
transfer
committee to do a transfer from reserve funds, so that will have to go back to your board about a transfer.
So,
we will.
Yeah, you don't have
yeah.
a quorum anyway. Tonight.
So I'll prepare the paperwork for both the Board of Selectmen and the Finance Committee for that.
Thank you.
And then David, the second agenda item for tri-board is the proposed schedule for a countdown to town meeting. Want to review that quickly?
Right, so we had talked about it originally at October 20th, fall town meeting, but the chair reminded me that we want to change the process by which we prepare for town meeting by including a public forum. So we have tentatively scheduled the public forum for Thursday, October 20th, with a target date of the special town meeting on October 27th. I checked with the assessors in terms of our work towards the putting together the recap, and that works for him. So that's my recommendation.
Are you asking us to open the warrant for fall town meeting tonight?
I'm asking that you set the warrant at the town meeting right now, and then you've got a countdown schedule. I think you open the warrant on June 1st.
Okay.
Should we not allow more than a week's time to, in case any revisions need to be made from the 20th to the 27th, or should we?
You mean a public forum?
Yes, correct.
What about the?
Yeah, I mean, is a week enough time? If you're going to have to review petitions or anything like that, you're probably going to need more time.
Well, as a practical matter, you need to post the warrant for a special 2 weeks in advance, so the public hearing would happen after you've posted. So there'd be no revisions to the posted warrant. I don't want to push back the public hearing too far, because then that means that you're really crushed for time. September and October to get everything done.
I think that the public forum isn't for us to change. It's to inform the people of what's going to be happening at the special town meeting. So we're not looking to change anything. It's just an informational meeting. If you have it a week's out before the town meeting, it does bring the freshness of our issues to the forefront before the town meeting itself.
Yeah, I mean, you're going to need finance.
So I think a week ahead is plenty.
Okay.
You're going to need the finance committee to go through it and see how far in debt we're going to be.
Well, that's not what the special forum is about. It's what we've already settled on at that point, and to inform the people.
Yeah, I mean, I think, in the spirit of continuous improvement, one of the things that we've heard loud and clear is that people want the opportunity to be able to really understand warrant articles before they walk in the door that night. So that's the idea behind that prior meeting, to support what Joyce is saying. So,
and we'll see if it works.
See if it works, yeah.
And for us to proofread our numbers.
All of that good stuff, yep. So would anybody like to make a motion to accept the schedule as presented? Or? Okay, is there a second?
I'll second.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. And school committee good? All right.
Did you get a list of the agenda, how it's going to go, Linda? Do you have one, just for the school committee? Did you send one to them?
The fall. You mean the meeting material?
Yeah.
Well, it's on.
No, not the meeting material, but the dates.
Oh, the countdown.
Could we get one?
Yes, I'll be sending that out to all affected departments. So that's the finance committee, the CPA committee, the moderator, town council, planning board, anybody who has a deadline in them.
So since Linda doesn't have it, or
Valerie,
thank you. Could we just read the dates for them so that they have an idea of what we're voting on?
Sure. Okay, so. Let me just go back to it because I just shut that down. So what we're proposing then is that we would, on May 11th, here we are, this says, David, that's why I asked the question, says select board opens the warrant.
I see.
Okay.
Yeah.
With a deadline of August 31st. So actually what you're suggesting is that we open the warrant.
June 1st,
right?
Right.
Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Okay. August 31st is a proposed date for the close of the warrant. On September 7th, the select board will review the warrant. On the 28th, finance committee, CPA, capital planning recommendations should be complete. The warrant and motions are prepared and sent to town council for review. So basically 1 month prior to the fall town meeting. October 5th, the legal review of motions and articles is complete. We should be signing the warrant. Then the October 6th would be the last day to post the warrant and publish notice of the special town meeting. October 14th, motions are distributed to the select board, moderator, finance committee, and anyone else who would be speaking to the articles. October 20th would be a public forum. Again, point being to allow the public the opportunity to garner better understanding of the articles in advance of town meeting, and then the actual town meeting on October 27th.
You're welcome.
Okay.
Public forum will be videotaped or live, or what's the venue for that?
We can request it. Yeah. We'll have a chance to talk more about this as we get closer. But I would think yes. That we get the best audience on TV. HPAT.
Okay.
Okay, and then the last agenda item for the tri board was just an opportunity for us to discuss the development of a plan for providing public services in the future, what we've been referring to as strategic plan. So what you have in the meeting material tonight is, there are two things. Last year, if everybody remembers, we did come up with a calendar that the tri board agreed to, and that was for the strategic planning and forecasting and budgeting. And we kind of laid out a calendar of what we planned on doing. And actually, I think I'm just realizing now, I'm not sure that that all made its way into the board material.
It didn't,
okay. So basically, I went back, and I probably circulated it to you guys via email, but I went back and took a look at that calendar to see what we did and what we didn't do. And we did accomplish a lot, but unfortunately, the wage study, the FTE analysis, and public forums
that's
were never
your,
done.
That's your red, our mistakes in red.
Yeah, not mistakes,
okay.
Just, yeah.
That's so, what we're lacking.
Room for improvement.
Right.
Yes.
So, you know, I guess this is a classic case of the spirit was willing, but we just couldn't quite get it all done. We ran into some obstacles along the way. But I think that it was still a sound concept, what we were trying to do last year. So with that in mind, this is just a calendar that's been laid out, and I'm just gonna walk down it quickly for the public, but not anticipating that we would come to agreement tonight, but just try to get the juices flowing to see if anybody has any further thoughts, wants to make comments or edits, and we can talk about that at another meeting, but very soon. So in the month of May, put down key departmental planning discussions. Tonight we're starting that process with the DPW. So Marla Warner's here to give us an overview of his thoughts about his time spent in Hadley so far. Hoping that next week we can have public safety in front of us. Mike Mason and Mike Spanknebel are two chiefs to have again kind of a commit time to talking about public safety and where that may be going over the next several years. And also schedule an information technology presentation by Northeast IT so that everybody has an understanding of not just the immediate kind of red items that they found that are inexpensive, but their broader perspective on the information technology infrastructure and what we're struggling with right now. Then in the month of June, hoping to have a wage study presentation, functional analysis of town departments and personnel, final report of the Municipal Building Committee, kind of close out the first phase of what they were charged to do, and then figure out where we need to go going forward. And a determination by the Select Board of any additional information we think we need to propose an initial five-year plan to the town. And we'll also be doing committee appointments. So that would all be in the month of June. In July, we can talk about the framework for a five-year plan, what it might look like, how best to present that to the residents. And, you know, we're coming up on some decision points that really need to be made. So, you know, are we going with a full-time fire department or not? Are we going with an ambulance service or not? Do we need additional police personnel? Is there any restructuring of town functions? We've heard during the SWOT analyses that we may eventually be looking at the hiring of a town planner because our planning board, as it's constituted today, is going to change. Do we need an HR function? Do we need an in-house IT function? A finance director? Purchasing director? We've talked about centralized purchasing. Do we need an assistant administrator? Do we need additional hours or actual administrative assistants themselves? And then also, how are we delivering? Are there functions that are being performed that we could outsource? You know, the pros and cons of that. Should we be talking about regionalization? Not necessarily us, you know, working with somebody else, but perhaps we have skill sets and available time in-house that would allow us to be the regionalized central repository by providing services to other municipalities. And then, when we're done talking about that, fitting in the building plans around that. So, And then moving into August.
But don't you think in this July timeframe too, I would like to see, and I know the school has done a five-year plan, some projections of what you might feel is going to be happening with the school in 5 years too, and where we might be going with that with census. And I know you always project out because of we always know how many births or whatever we have, or how many people come into town, or
how many babies have been birthed.
Babies are coming. But give that an idea of where our school system is too, and what is needed there. So I think that plays into that five-year plan also.
Absolutely.
The school committee has already asked the superintendent and business manager to develop 3 5-year plans. What would happen to the schools at assuming FY17 funding levels went on?
Mm-hmm.
What we think a level services budget would be, and what we think modest increases to service levels would cost for 5 years, including looking at census and making some enrollment projections. Mm-hmm. So I think we will have that. My goal would be that we would have that in June and reviewing it and ready for July.
That's great.
Do you think that anytime you'd be able to get any revenue or expenses figures on regionalizing?
We have definitely been talking about that, about what we can do with schools around us. And I don't think we could have that by July, but I think it has to be part of our thinking for the future.
We spoke with it in a few of the tri-board meetings, and I just wondered where you were at. And you had mentioned it a few times yourself. You know, even if it's not with another town, how about a private concern, you know? The Chinese American school.
I've already met with them.
I just spoke with them this week, actually.
Yep.
That's why I'm bringing it up.
Yep. So I think that's a longer term. I don't think we have a good plan for that by July, but I think it has to be in our long-term thinking.
Yeah.
And we've always thought, even years back, of what we could share with different positions and how that would work.
Yeah, and we're actually looking at that with some of with some changes going into fiscal year 17. We're looking at some shared positions.
Yeah.
But looking more globally at regionalization is a bigger look.
So again, the goal here would be heading into really the end of August, being in a position where we could go to the town for the first time with an initial public forum where we're saying, look, here's a global perspective of where Hadley's at right now. You know, take an inventory. Here are the issues town-wide that we see. A sense from the select board as to what the priorities are. Again, first pass, but then now we're going back to everybody in town and saying, this is what we see, tell us where we're wrong, where you have a differing viewpoint, et cetera.
But, we've been talking about it. Same with the wage study, same with regionalization. It's the same with an ambulance service. We need all the options on the table, not just this is what it's going to cost us for an ambulance service for the town to function.
We had options on the table. That is nothing new.
Whatever you had was 4 years ago before I even got on the board, and I never really
updated.
So the good news is, Jen, because you pointed that out, what's outlined here is that in the month of June, that line item that says determination by the select board of any additional information needed to propose an initial 5-year plan to the town. So everybody here would have the opportunity to say, raise their hand, but with the idea that in the month of July, we would really be in recommendation mode, so that we would have already gotten everything that we needed to from fire personnel related to the fire department and any other related parties. So, I know it's aggressive, but I also know that I think going into fall town meeting, we need to have a lot more answers. I think loud and clear,
exactly.
We all heard there were a lot of questions.
Exactly.
This time.
We need the fact checks, and we need the facts in everybody's hand before we present anything.
Right. But again, I mean, in fairness, I just want to say that for the people who are charged with making the recommendations, we need to be crystal clear on what information we need in order to make a decision. Because sometimes what happens is we get kind of caught in this churn where we keep feeling like we don't have enough information, but then the people who want us to make a decision don't know exactly what it is we're looking for. So that doesn't work either, mm-hmm. So.
I guess my main concern is getting our financial house in order. Mm-hmm. I've talked to our treasurer and Link about this, and we're gonna put undue pressure on her with all these things we're talking about, borrowing, paying off debt. And one thing we've talked about is she has a capacity to do all this, but she even would like another committee established, maybe bankers, insurance, financial planners. She could do it by being an elected official, or we could do it to enhance her decisions when we get into borrowing the money, how much we need, be it infrastructure, buildings. Maybe Linda can add to this a little bit what we spoke about. I don't mean to put you on the spot, but explain to the board a little bit what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, what we were talking about is casting a net out there for some advisors that we have in town and getting some advice from people that have served before in some capacity. And Donald's named some of the professions, people that might be willing to come in and advise financially as to where we would be going. Mm-hmm. And I think this is something that we were talking about doing as a part of town hall with the town hall financial team, so that we could better fit into the plan that you're coming up with, better fit in how we would do this, what we could do, how we could do something differently with investments, borrowing, and other things that are the treasurer's responsibility. And it's not a matter of sure, I'm comfortable, I'll make decisions, but my decisions would be better if I have a team of financial advisors. And that's what we were informally talking about, is forming some kind of an advisory committee to come in. And I think that would fit in very nicely with, hopefully getting some better answers back on perhaps a better timeline.
Don't you have the availability with DOR and David Eisenthal. Isn't he your go-to person for borrowing
and
telling us what our financial, I mean, he usually gives us a
report
each year.
He's in the borrowing, and then we have an advisor at Morgan Stanley, and we have an advisor at Bartholomew, and we have a number of, and we have two banks where we're very happy with the advisors. What I'd like is...
You're talking financial strategy.
A strategy and sort of an across the board, a little more global approach, someone who looks at the whole picture. What we have is a lot of individual advisors, and we can pull them together, but they kind of all have their vested interests too, or they have their niches of what it is that they're advising us on. If you give us the OPEB money, this is how we will invest it. That's just one. We have an OPEB advisor in that way. We also have the OPEB actuarial, this is how much you want to be putting in, and this is what your picture looks like. But we don't necessarily have them in the same place at the same time. There are some people in town who know a lot more about those things than any one person. And if we put those, including me, put them together in one room. So we're just kind of talking about getting a financial
advisory team. Something that would be out of the scope of the finance committee's regular duties.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's
what I'm trying to
bring about.
Although they would be welcome. They also would be welcome. And in fact, I think...
Throughout all these meetings since we started the tri-board, our biggest downfall is our revenue expectations. We know what our expenses are, pretty much to the penny.
Yeah.
But our revenue numbers are just not adding up to our expenses. And we need to get a handle on that. You know? And every number that's come out has been quite high, and we've dug ourselves a hole here that we need to do something. There's no doubt about it.
So again, that's the whole point of going through this process, because we need to determine what it is we're trying, what expenses are we trying to cover. It's not just level services, but it's also if we have other needs in the town, and we're either going to need to find a new revenue source, decrease those expenses, or some hybrid approach. So
I guess the major decisions this committee would make would be coming up with exactly how much borrowing capacity we have.
Yep.
And bringing forth that to us so we don't overextend ourselves.
Right.
And that's my only reasoning, really, because we've got issues before us, and nobody's going to say, oh, we're going to borrow $10 million, but what is the ramifications going to be for $10 million? Are we actually going to be able to pay it or not, or go into debt and not pay it? You know, so that we have to have those answers.
But Linda, that's your purview as an elected official.
Sure.
If you want to set up a committee
sure.
to
recommend,
or do whatever you want, I mean, that's whatever makes you comfortable.
Yeah, and I think that's what we have planned to do. We're just sharing with you that what we've discussed. I think of it as a financial brainstorming group.
Mm-hmm.
And so that a lot of the things that you discuss at meetings like this, maybe we take off to another group and really talk about, you know, what our, you know, what someone else who's been directly in the business for 20, 30 years thinks about
what
we maybe
ought
to be
all
doing.
The people that are involved in the tri-board are great at crunching the numbers and making it work, but we're already past that. We've been doing that for
mm-hmm.
4 years I've been here now, and we need to move on. We need a real plan here. Because
and the good news is we're all part of that solution.
I know. I've been saying it right along, but you guys have just been going on and on.
I've been listening to it right along.
I guess what I'm trying to bring about is we have a lot of talented people in this community, and we don't utilize ad hoc committees enough, where it doesn't cost us anything. These people volunteer. Every time we go out and ask a consultant to do this, it's ka-ching, ka-ching out of our pocketbook. If we can get an ad hoc committee, it would be minimal expenses, and we'll end up with the same results.
Or better.
Or even better. That's
or
right.
better.
Because they understand the...
Because they know Hadley.
Yeah. Yep. Okay, so I'm just trying to, you know, be conscious of time here. Again, this is just a first pass at this, so I'm just asking everybody if you could take a look at this and really think this through in terms of what is involved here. David, you in particular, because looks like there's a pretty darn big to-do list
that's
over here for you to spearhead.
Somebody's got to do this.
You'll send that to us?
Yes, so we'll send it to both of the finance and school committee, and then if people could just provide comment back, and then we can kind of, again, a lot of it is going to be at the select board, but wanted to make it part of the tri-board's thought process, and again, any input you have would be greatly appreciated.
We have a thought process rebidding the center of town land request that we had, since we had some interest come in since the bid opening occurred. What's that?
You want to talk about that now?
No, I just want to make sure we get it onto the schedule.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Excuse me.
Yeah, rebid.
Please.
Yep, and I would say that it would be in the merry month of May, right?
Quick as possible.
Yeah, well,
yeah, we're May 11th.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
Do we need to take a vote on that, David? Or do we all put it on the agenda next
week? Sounds like
you're
taking it under advisement, and then you'll be discussing implementation at your next tri-board meeting.
I don't think you just heard what we talked about.
We're talking about the rebidding of the land
property
request for the center of town.
Right. Why don't you and I have a conversation about that, about the new information that came up, and then we'll present that to the board after
next week.
Yeah, next week.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
Okay. Does anybody want to adjourn the tri-board meeting?
Do they have any more questions?
Before we adjourn, was there a schedule discussed about regular meetings and when they would occur and how often? Do we have time to have that discussion,
sure.
or at least to schedule the next
sure.
meeting?
Wouldn't you like to go back to your committees and find out what works best for them?
Well, I would just like to know whether, it didn't used to be part of the select board meeting. What's the current thinking on that? Are we going to meet monthly, bi-monthly?
Yeah, we were
bring all of that back, but I'd
like
a sense
of
it
once
thinking.
A month, you know.
Yeah.
What works for you guys? Do you like it earlier in the evening?
We liked it at 6
yes.
o'clock. We just did it tonight. Because we did.
We could do it at 6 the next
one meeting.
What's the feeling of the board? Do they want it encompassed in the select board meeting or segregated from it?
Segregated.
I think segregated.
I do
David,
too.
You had your hand up?
So the, what we were doing in the past is we were meeting on the second Wednesday of the month at 6 p.m. for tri-board, and then we go into the select board meeting at 7.
So that would be June 8th.
So do you want, can you both go back to your boards and ask? I mean, that's, is that fine with the select board?
The second Wednesday, 6 to 7 is the proposal.
Yep.
And I can email you after I poll the school committee and you'll communicate.
Okay. Do you want to do June and then August and not do July? Do you want to do it every month? What do you think for the summer?
Didn't you just say you were looking for a lot of information in July that you would be getting in June?
Wait, yeah, we will be in the process of confirming our five-year projection of June, so.
Okay, so July would be a good.
Maybe we skip June and meet in July.
July, that'd be a good idea. So July 13th is the second Wednesday of that month. 6 o'clock on July 13th, is that fit for everybody?
Yep.
Yep. All right, anything else for the tri-board meeting? Nope. Okay, does anybody want to make a motion to adjourn tri-board?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Okay, so we have a 7:45 appointment, and we also have somebody who's a guest here to talk about another article. So may I just ask how long, David, do you expect that the North Hadley Dam discussion?
Well, I think the work of the board tonight is simply to hear the progress report and to sign the historic preservation restriction and the CPA grant agreement. Those are the two action items for the board.
Okay.
I don't mind waiting. I need about 4 hours.
I knew that, so that's
I'm
great.
I'm going home to bed waiting. Open
I guess I'll break it down. I'll shorten it.
Could we meet tomorrow morning at 5?
Sure. I'm up.
I'm up at 5.
Thank you, Marla.
I mean, if they want to find my way, I can stay.
Thank you. Kristen?
Compensatory
time.
Okay.
So this is Kristen DeBoer from Kestrel Trust. Kristen's here with us tonight to update us on the Lake Warner Dam project.
Okay, thank you for having me. This was a flyer that, so I'll get this pass out, that was prepared for town meeting. I don't know if anyone actually received it. So that's to begin with. Actually, may I grab one to so this outlines the progress that we have made this year, which is significant, I believe. First off, we did go through the permitting process with the Hadley Conservation Commission, Natural Heritage, et cetera, and have a permit in hand to do work within the low flow season for the river, which is July 1st to September 30th. We have secured the state funding. In fact, we received the funding today as is an electronic funds transfer from the state. And then we'll talk today about the CPA funds of $100,000. We've also raised close to $120,000 that we've been spending on project costs to date, including final design, but also holding some in reserve for a maintenance fund over the long term. We've cleared the title with the abutters. We have established an agreement with the Friends of Lake Warner, which is a new nonprofit entity dedicated to the area, which has agreed to take the dam after it's repaired. And then we've drafted the historic preservation restriction for the Historic Commission, which we'll talk about tonight too. We prepared the site in order to have cranes in there for operations, so the trees were cleared with the permission of the town as well. And so that leads us to the timeline. We did follow a public bidding process because we kind of took that as what was needed. There were two bids submitted. They were both significantly over the estimated project budget and secured funds. There were also defects in the bids in the way that they were received, so we had to reject the bids. So since then, we've been regrouping as far as, you know, what is the opinion of probable cost really look like, given some of the input that we got from the contractors. So our engineers have revised that figure upward a tad. quite a bit, but not within reach, I believe, to 380,000. We've also talked with the state about an additional, the legislature that is, about additional legislative earmark to help make up for any funding gap that we might have. So at this point, our hope is that we can sign the CPA contract and historic preservation restriction and potentially move forward with a private bidding process, which might result in a better pricing. So I'm happy to answer questions.
What was the estimates originally on it?
The original estimate was 225,000.
It's gone up to 380 now?
That's the opinion of probable cost from the engineer, and the bids were higher than that.
My main concern last week, and I think that's one of the reasons why we put this off, was the restriction. How preventive is it for, like, say, a hydroelectric facility there in the future?
It allows one.
It allows for hydro if the owners choose to pursue that.
Yeah, we weren't sure, and so that's one of the reasons why we put it off.
Yeah.
I really didn't have any other questions beside that.
Okay, so in stated in the historic preservation restriction is a permitted use of hydroelectric, and I think it's, let's see.
I had a chance to read it, and I saw it there, yes.
So it's, Grantor's Reserve Rights, Section 6. I believe it's in that section. So we anticipated that as a possibility.
So the ownership of the dam will go to Friends of Lake Warner, but Kessel Trust will still own the land around it?
No.
No.
We've never owned any land. In fact, we've owned, so Valley Land Fund acquired the rights to the dam from the Boisberts on their side. Mm-hmm. And when we did a title review, it became clear that the other abutters also had rights. And so within the last year, we transferred those rights to Lake Warner LLC, which is the entity, the legal entity that holds all right and title to the dam, but there's no land associated with it.
Any other questions from the board on the either the restriction or the CPA?
So are they going to be going back to CPA for more money in the fall?
I'm hoping that state legislative earmark will come through for FY17, which would give us enough additional funds.
At a minimum, we need to extend the deadline, the sunset provision within the CPA article. So we have a draft article for the special town meeting, which would do that. The next regularly scheduled CPA meeting is September 12th, second Monday in September. So we would obviously, even though it's not technically an appropriation from CPA, we certainly want to work with CPA in order to make sure that they were comfortable with the extension of the sunset provision.
So what's the pleasure of the board?
I move to sign the agreement.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed?
Okay. So when do you figure you'll go out to bid again?
If we can move forward with the private bidding, we would try again to see what the price might be for this summer or next summer, depending on availability of contractors.
Is that something we need to send Kristen along with, or can we sign it later on? And
we can sign that and get it over to the historic preservation restriction.
Do you want it now, Molly, or do you want
it? I'm just asking.
Historic preservation also needs input from the historic commission, so we would transmit that document after you sign it, send it over to the historic commission for their action, that the grant agreement we can sign and send to Kestrel Trust.
Okay. Are you comfortable with that?
Yeah, just clarification. So the two documents you just agreed to sign are the CPA contract and the historic preservation.
Right.
Yep.
All right, and then I would work with you on the procurement issue. Is that, or is that settled?
My mind is settled. I have documentation that this is not subject to public procurement. You don't have to adhere to any of my requirements.
Okay, we'll try again.
Were you able to ascertain out of the bids that came in, what was the problematic area, why they were so much higher?
It appeared to be the cost of concrete has gone up in part, and also an estimation of the just general mobilization and site preparation seems quite a bit higher than we had estimated. And then the third area was the water flow control.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Krista.
All right. Thank you so much.
All right. Marlo Warner is here for his 7:45, now to be 8:15 appointment with us to present information relating to the Department of Public Works. Welcome, Marlo.
Thanks. Update on my time here in Hadley. Well, it'll be 10 weeks on Thursday since I've been here. Some days seem like a lifetime, other days I don't know where they go, but so far the public, the board, town hall staff have been extremely helpful to me understanding this form of government. I can come from this form, understanding where everything's at, who I go to for resources. Police and fire chief have been very helpful. They've kind of taken me under my wing and kind of dragged me along. I've had a lot of visitors down to the DPW yard, some very good discussions with some of the taxpayers, some very good information. Other than that, I'm about ready to roll up the sleeves and really just move forward now that I've gotten used to the community. And I've evaluated the DPW. I don't want to say evaluate, but I've asked hundreds of questions. I've probably driven people kind of crazy. John from the sewer department has been very helpful with a lot of questions of mine as far as the treatment plant, as well as Dennis. So the DPW has many moving parts, and as we know, another moving part got thrown at us with the MS4 permit coming out. So I only want to give you a quick overview tonight of where I'm at and how I see things and maybe my goals going forward in the near future and then beyond. Because like I said, I really could take 4 hours of your time right now to go through every bit of information.
And we're certainly pleased that you won't, so that's good.
Okay. Yeah. but certainly, I think I'll just hit the main points, and if anybody has any questions or they want to reach out to me whenever, that's fine. I can explain further. The first thing I took a look at when I entered the position was assets. Obviously, the assets at the yard is the equipment, the trucks, the vehicles, and of course staffing. I looked at how the workload was distributed each day, such as the highway department, water department, and sewer department. And early on, I realized that I needed a lot of sticky notes. I needed a lot of paper because there was no system in place to really track the work. Everything was being tracked with a phone call, you know, hand notes, sticky notes. And then some of the work is being tracked, put back into computers on different staff members' computers and their own Word documents, whatnot. Mm-hmm. So where I was going with this is it still acts a little independent divisions as opposed to a DPW. And what I want to do going forward on that part of the system is I would like to put a work order system in place. A work order system put in place can do many things for the DPW rather than all that information in different areas of town on computers. It can bring it all into one spot so that if the board wanted a report from me tonight, I could pull it off my computer and bring it, stuff like that. Our things now sometimes can take me a day or two to find information, whereas I can pull that up in a few minutes once we got a work order system in play and up and running. There's a lot of time used trying to track that information from different staff members that may be on vacation, they may be out for the day. Whereas if I can put everything under that global hood, so to speak, anybody can drop the information, even if I was on vacation or whatnot and the board needed some information, taxpayer needed some information. One of the main things I looked at is vehicles, because vehicles seem to be the big sticking point in a lot of communities. They're very expensive, you have preventative maintenance, you need to take care of them, they need to last a long time. So there's another piece of software that I'd like to set a mechanic up with that will track the vehicles. It can track all the monies that are put into them in one spot. All the service work, all the repairs, the hours, and it will draw a report within the system. So each vehicle, if you wanted a complete report on that backhoe since 1996, you bring that vehicle number up and it'll give you a complete report. It sounds very cumbersome. It sounds like there's a lot of time that needs to be put in it by the staff. But once the system's in place, it's probably an eighth of the time. Punch a few keys rather than all that paper, find the filing cabinet. And what this will do is it will, overall with the vehicles and as far as the time management part of it, it's going to streamline the workloads. It's going to help streamline the priorities for the supervision. And it also, it'll be a great connection with the public. I mean, you can communicate via email through this system. The modules that I'm looking at, let me call them modules, the company that I'm looking at, you have your, what they call maintenance edge, and that can consist of your vehicle maintenance and buildings, or only vehicle maintenance. And then you have your mobile 311, which is your water, sewer, highway. So it's two separate entities. Everything is in the cloud. It's web-based. To go with a very expensive system, we don't have the IT in place for, you know, with the servers and all that. So this is something that I wanted to do fairly soon going forward, to start tracking some of this information. It's real important information. It's part of performance management, they call it. So we can get a good idea on staffing levels in itself too. You know, we're light in staffing, which divisions were light, we might be heavy. I'm leaning towards we're a little light in a lot of areas right now, but I haven't really gotten that far with all that.
So that you know what the question is on everybody's mind right now who's listening to this.
What's the cost?
There you go.
Okay. I want to use a quick couple of examples of what's happened since I've been here and give an example of what it took just of my time. We had a water main break last select board meeting, and part of these modules are GIS. GIS can be built into this, which is the mapping of all our infrastructure, pinpoint, engineer-grade infrastructure, pinpoint. It took us about 7 hours to get that main shut down and repaired. Still well ahead of contracting a contractor at 10 o'clock at night, 11 o'clock at night. What I realized early on in the process was I have maps of the infrastructure.
Physical maps.
They're in four places in town, four different buildings. There's, I believe, piles over in a room over in the senior center. We have some at the treatment plant. We have some at the water plant. We have piles of them in the highway trailer. And just to find those maps that night, where do you find them? So that's part of housekeeping, but part of the housekeeping is not having a place for all these to begin with. I don't want to get too far off track with that, but we want to get all the maps, and we want to get our couple hundred years of institutional knowledge with some gentlemen that work down there, and we got to get this stuff into a computer. The community I came from, a lot of it was done. You have a few missing pieces now and then, but you know, the van heads out, they bring it up on the iPad, they bring up the street we're on, it'll locate the gate valves, it'll tell you exact ties from different points where it's at. They could have shut that thing down in an hour's time, including travel to get here, providing the valves were shut down. So that's a prime example. You already got the crew on scene, and we don't have it throttled down. We don't have it shut down yet because we were hunting. Mm-hmm. I had to call an additional staff of people that might know where everything was to be shut down. So that's an important piece in putting everything together. Route 9, we're in the process of marking Route 9, all our water works for the contractor, Mass DOT, and the gas company. The guys have spent about 3 days total time searching maps, because they can't find on the print that was presented, things weren't there. They had been abandoned, they had been retired, and they were moved, something new got put in. So they've been hunting high and low through these maps and trailers, and they're still marking Route 9 out here. Whereas they could bring that stuff right up on an iPad eventually, or a tablet. It's gonna take over a week, two people to mark Route 9 inside of the confines of the scope of that project, where it should probably maybe take a day, day and a half at most. So I don't wanna bore you with the long details, but I think at the end of the day, you're talking somewhere around $11,000 startup for this program. And it's about $7,000 a year for the three major divisions. But in quick math, not having this, just in these two instances, it cost us hundreds of hours of man hours.
And overtime.
So, you know, do the math in 6 months, you do it in a year. Naturally, you don't have big dig safe projects like this, but it happens on the regular dig safes too. They can't find stuff.
How elaborate is that mechanical program?
Excuse me?
How elaborate is that mechanical program for the equipment?
This is what I liked about that.
Because you came over and looked at all the books in the sewer plant and said, what is that? And could that be incorporated into the, you know, the operations of the equipment, the major equipment in the wastewater and the water?
Yes, yes. The system I'm looking at, it's actually, it's made by Dude Solutions. They're all over the East Coast. They're booming with municipalities.
Dude Solutions?
Yes. I'd rather stick with Maintenance Edge and Mobile 311 within Dude Solutions, but I had to put that out there. They're a very good company. They've got very good ratings. And it can be tailored. It can be tailored from the first-time user, or you can ramp it up and make it as intricate as you want on the other end. And that's what I like about it. Because you can start out with, so to speak, small steps, get the information you need on equipment. You can build it out for you and Dennis's reports in the treatment plant, build it out that your DEP forms are built right into it. So if you're taking information in, you can build right into it and you can send reports from this system. So again, it's a global thing. It's bringing everything under one umbrella rather than two or three computers just in one office there. And John can't get Dennis's reports, he's out sick. Mm-hmm. You know. I don't mean to point you out, but those are examples. And I like the fact that it's accessible. I believe others can have access to it through standard key password or whatnot. So the other part is the maintenance part of it on the vehicles. It's not only going to help the DPW, I think it's going to be a very big help to the police and fire department, because we can track everything. The one thing I realized over the years is tracking vehicles and whatnot. The last thing you remember is the big expense, but it doesn't give you a real vision of what you've spent on that piece of equipment if you don't have a good record. When I say these things, the staff does a wonderful job down at the DPW yard with what we got to work with. They've been very supportive. A few of them have come to me and said, this will be a good idea, let's do this. You know, people are driving me crazy. And when I say that, it's one of these things I think we have to do pretty soon to start tracking things. It's going to take a while to bring everything together and get it into this system. It's going to be a haul. It's going to be crazy. This is crazy. But once we get everything there, it's going to be so simple to use.
And would the vendor provide training to the staff?
Another great point. Unlimited training. I've had two conference calls with the owner of the company. And I set up another one for next week, more of a phone call than a conference call. After I left the meeting, I wanted to touch base with them after the meeting tonight. I'm still looking at a few more. I haven't set up conference calls, but this setup seems the best for Hadley. I'm not really entertaining buying these $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 infrastructure programs that are, I mean, we'll never use. We'll never touch the surface on one. They contain here in Hadley. So the other half of this is the GIS, and MS4 comes into play. We got to get stuff mapped, engineered grade. I mean, we can use the mapping, the layers here, but it's not real accurate. In other words, a water gate might be 20 feet from where it's actually showing on that assessor's map layer. Whereas you're out there at 2 o'clock in the morning, if you can be within 3 feet, boy, that's a good feeling. So you got two pieces of the puzzle. We have the expense to put the software in place for time management and equipment tracking. And then you have the GIS piece of it. The GIS can come later and be built into the same system. So in other words, if they get a work order to go out to whatever, Wally Street, they punch the address in, they punch in hydrant, they punch in water gate, it'll give them a pinpoint, they can drive right up to it where the gate is in the grass or behind a tree or whatever. So that takes money. That's the expensive part of putting this all together.
But you're saying it could be a phased approach?
Yes. I don't know how phased now that we got MS4 into place, because we're going to have to, that, I wanted to touch a little on that, because it's basically the old permit, only they really ramped it up on steroids. I mean, they're really digging into the system, pinpointing everything. That's the expense, you know, where every manhole is, every invert, every pipe in and out of a manhole and catch basin. So having this stuff GIS, I think, is going to come into play if everything hits like they're saying. Well, it has hit, so it needs to play into part of this. And my thought was, why not do one-stop shopping with a little added expense if you have an engineering firm in here and hit water, sewer, and drainage all at once, is my thinking going forward. And I have no cost on that at this point, but it's a thought, rather than bring them in three different times.
Are these, all these companies interchangeable with most of the engineering firms as far as the information that they do have right now?
Yes. So in other words, if say Kyan Bond or CI's got some GIS information on some of our pipes or whatever, the answer is yes, it can be uploaded to mobile 311. So you know, the other thing is, do we keep GIS separate so we can keep everything separated out to meet the permit? And you know, that's stuff that I'm swimming through. Like I said, I could spend hours here, but I haven't really dove into that completely. I'm just trying to give you a general overview of where I want to go going forward. Excuse me.
Is there any grant money available for these projects with Flint, Michigan, and Springfield being underwater for the last 3 days? Do you anticipate grants being able to fund any of these projects?
Such as the MS4?
Yeah, and the software.
The software, I can look into maybe to the COG or PVPC and see if they got anything for us. I know it sounds expensive, but you take the three module part of it, the three division module part of it, and you divide it three ways, it's, you know, $3,000 a year. And I can assure you that we will get that back in man hours by far.
I think you've got a lot of man hours in implementing it and putting it together, especially if you don't know where the valves are now.
Yeah, that's the GIS part of it.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going back to the asset management and vehicle part of it and whatnot. So in order to do asset management, we have to know where all our assets are, and that's the GIS part of it. Mm-hmm. Pulling Mr. Klimoski's mind in and Mr. Pavinsky, Mr. Warkevich's mind all together, what these things are. When they come into GIS, these things, there's certain things that these gentlemen know that's here that they don't have to go look for a print. It's behind the oak tree, behind the white picket fence next to whoever's house. It's not on the road, so it's very hard to find.
Yeah, the biggest thing throughout the years, Michael would leave a water break, and myself or Dennis would be there, and we'd make a little map, not to scale, and add to the plan, which you've seen a number of times already, and oh, it's somewhere. Who did that last, you know? Mm-hmm. It's a big runaround sometimes in an emergency.
Yeah, and the other part of it is the GIS, this particular mobile 311, they update daily, not every 30 days, every 60 days. So if we did a water gate replacement, water meter repair on Mount Warner Road, we get the information sent in within 24 hours. It's right in our plan. So there's a problem there a week later where they need to dig safe something for another utility. It's there. It's like almost instant.
Presently, you're saying that all of our fleet maintenance records are being kept on paper still?
Yes. Yes.
I guess that leads me to a question. How large is our fleet today? How many vehicles? And how does one mechanic keep all this maintenance up to date? There's got to be some time that they're not taking care of these vehicles. One mechanic, just, it's impossible.
Well,
how many vehicles in our fleet approximately?
I have not done the exact count. I finally got the spreadsheet today on everything. That was the next step of evaluating the vehicles themselves and where they fit.
Haven't we always just had one, John?
We do have that information.
We've always had just one
somewhere.
Mechanic.
Yeah,
right.
You've always had
one mechanic, but over the period of the last 10 years, you probably went from, it was around 100 when I was in a garage, and I think you're well over 125 or so.
Registered pieces.
At least.
Yeah.
And that's registered equipment, wastewater equipment, water equipment. I mean, you know, what do you consider a piece of equipment? You know, we've got mixers, and we've got mechanical equipment. We got lawnmowers. We got weed whackers. I mean, it's
each
department has their own, yeah. But
heavy equipment,
yeah. Trucks, dump trucks, pickups, cars. We're somewhere in the 45 range. I think including or 50, including police and fire. That's not a real. I think it's a close number, but it's not a mean number. So the other part of evaluating equipment we have at the DPW yard is looking at, do we buy a piece of equipment later down the road where it fits, where it can perform two functions, so that we don't have to have them two pieces registered and maintaining them. They make some pretty good equipment today that you can do multiple functions with. They have what's called a whacker machine that it takes the place of a skid steer. It takes the place of a sidewalk snowplow machine. That's about conglomerating the assets. You know, we got to look at pieces of equipment like that. So, you know, maybe one piece can do the job that three did. Maybe two of them sat there a third of the year and didn't go until winter, whereas we can have one piece running year-round doing the different functions. Those are some of the things that I want to look at when I look at the whole fleet. I got the list. I want to figure out how many vehicles are assigned to each division, what they do. Do we have too many vehicles? Can we consolidate and make it work? Do we not have enough? Do we have just enough? That's something I'm just starting to really
I guess into. What I'm trying to convey, 25 years ago when I was a selectman, we had three police cruisers and one mechanic. Mm-hmm. Today we have 11 with three more coming on board from UMass, and we still only have one mechanic.
Right.
I don't know how he can do it. It's impossible in my mind to maintain those vehicles to the point where they have to be maintained.
Right.
Because the schedule you get behind on your maintenance, all it does is take life out of your vehicles. That's all it does.
Mm-hmm. You know, with that being said, we have a highway staff member almost every day of the week working with Brian, to sum it up, probably 80% of the time. So we take away from highway for the day. Sometimes you have to fill in the sewer department, so.
But there's a way to set a schedule where you do maintenance on vehicles. I mean,
right,
you don't just work on one car a day, you know.
Right.
I mean, you can go to anybody, automobile shop, and they don't do just one.
Right, preventative maintenance.
Preventative maintenance, that's just a given.
Yeah.
So, I mean.
Yeah.
But your point is you're looking for the tools necessary
day.
To help you manage that.
Right.
So that you're focusing on the right vehicles, not just cycling through.
And you know, and again, I want to say it's not the mechanic's fault not having every great record we need under a piece of equipment. I mean, everybody does a good job with what they have down there. It's important, you know. There's an old saying, it's not about the people, it's about the process. It's about the tools they're given. And I mean, it's right up that alley on a lot of these things here in Hadley. So
the mechanic also does a lot more than just mechanic. When we have a winter storm, he's out of that garage, he's in our biggest truck, going from South Hadley to Sunderland back and
mm-hmm.
forth constantly. So he doesn't get any, very little mechanic work done during the winter if we have a adverse winter. He's in the truck doing his major duty to keep our streets safe.
And then
last
winter we had no winter, so,
yeah.
You know, New England.
So you have a couple of other items on here too?
Yeah, I just to touch base, you know, the resource management, the asset management I kind of touched on,
mm-hmm.
Infrastructure. You got to know, we have to know where these things are with the GIS, so we know where there are, just to start. I'll touch on water pipes. We have to know where everything is. we have to do good maintenance, which the water department has really taken off and gotten back to some really solid maintenance on our water system. As far as replacing water pipes, I want to hit on water and sewer going forward. Water pipes, there's the history we're talking about. Water pipes, you can go by age, or you can go by the amount of breaks and so many hundred feet in an area. So there's different ways of determining water pipe and when it needs to be replaced. Age is a tough one, because I've seen 100-year-old pipes get dug up and it was like the day they were put in. I've seen them where they've worn through. So my focus on water pipes would be your 4-inch in Route 9. That would be my focus going forward. As the MassDOT goes forward with this project, we ought to follow suit and get ahead of them so that we're not digging the highway.
Well, exactly. They've already said they're going to be, yeah, and plans are going all the way to the malls eventually at some date and time. So
I haven't dug into the master plan yet, or dug into the capital, but this is just how I want to approach it right now. This is as far as I've gotten with it. As far as the sewer, I think we have a few videos. We have some films down there. It's scattered. We have some of Route 9, a few of the other streets. Sewer is a little bit easier to determine what the risk management is on a certain pipe. The most effective way and the most obvious way to determine whether a sewer pipe needs to be replaced or repaired is camera, flushing camera, flush with vector and camera. The other option out there is smoke testing, but smoke testing does not really tell you unless you have a big open hole in the pipe and it comes up through the cracks in the road. But that is the most effective way to determine what's going on with your sewer system, your sewer mains. There's two ways of going about it. If we want to evaluate the whole sewer system, we can flush ahead of a contractor who just does the cammering, which would save a lot of money, or you can do both the flush and camera the lines as you go. And I'll also say it's something we should look at on Route 9, I think, not this next section, but the section after we're back into the sewer on Route 9, I think, if it serves me right. So that's what I'm looking at right now. I can work on coming up with some figures if that's what we want to do, like with the sewer system. We want to evaluate the whole system, see where we're at. And you can set some risk management on it. Hey, Route 9 looks great. I think we can just line it. Middle Street, we need to replace a couple hundred feet of that. You know, you can make those calls, then you can come up with pricing and see where we need to be.
You know, one thing that you made to me really helped me understand the situation a great deal. When you said, based on 100%, Hadley is about at 85%. We need to start attacking that 15%. And that really made me understand where we're at in our infrastructure and what we need. It was a good explanation, and it really helped me the way you explained it to me.
I think we can approach it methodically, with conviction. From the community I came from, I worked almost every night in my position in that community with sewer backups or water main breaks or something wrong. So I want to say that, yes, your infrastructure is aging like every other community, but I've been on one water main break since I've been here. I haven't been on a single sewer backup. That doesn't mean that we don't have bad pipes out there, but I think if we take the methodical approach, put some money away, and decide where we want to start so that 10 years, 15 years, 20 years down the road, it doesn't all decide to fail at once. I guess I'm trying to say, I mean, the sky's not falling on your infrastructure, but we got to evaluate it, and we got to find out where
we're
going to make those repairs.
We don't have to make those repairs. We're putting ourselves right at this question.
Again, originally, the last five or eight years, we have taken sections and cleaned and videotaped and check the condition of the pipes themselves. I mean, the problem we ran into on Lorena Lane was that would have probably been one of the last roads we ever thought of cleaning, cammering, and inspecting, because it was a newer project, you know, at the time.
Yeah.
You know, so you just never know. Unless you put X amount of feet or with this road this year, you know, take a road a year or something, yeah, to clean and camera, you're really not going to know the condition of the whole town. And that's where we had started, and we just fell off the deep end here.
Yeah, if you wanted to do approximately your 21 miles, so you're looking at probably $200,000 to get the videotape and the reports on it. So, I mean, there's a number that I know is pretty accurate. But
so, Marlo, it sounds like a lot of what you're working on is going to be going into the overall capital plan recommendations in terms of, you know, maybe like the GIS, certainly the project, more project-oriented work. But what I heard you say is that you have an imminent need, not a want, but in your professional opinion, an imminent need for resource management tracking through this $11,000 software.
Yes.
Right. Have you talked with David at all about possible funding sources for that? Or?
I was going to speak to him after this evening. The decision I need to make is, do I want to go with just the vehicle module right now,
right,
or do we want to purchase the vehicle and building module?
Mm-hmm.
That way there Gary can start tracking what he's putting into the buildings in time and
mm-hmm.
parts and pieces. So and you're talking, I think, $2,700 or $3,400 startup for both of them, and like $2,700 a year to maintain.
Mm-hmm.
But again, it sounds like a lot of money, $11,000 to $15,000 a year, but you break it up into three or four ways amongst the divisions. I think it's got a huge payback.
Yeah, I mean, certainly the picture you've painted, not having this in place,
yeah,
is costing us an awful lot more.
I had personally found myself with 25 sticky notes on my desk.
Yeah.
Get back to this person, get back to that person, let them know when we can do this, when we can do that. Now you have it right at your fingertips with a work order. You can show the status of it. Hey, it's scheduled for next Monday.
Mm-hmm.
It's a great way to interact with the taxpayer too, I think. So they know exactly where their complaint or their concern is at as far as being addressed.
Okay. Anything else? Questions, comments for Marlo?
Did you have a change order for us tonight?
Change order.
I don't have one for you, but I'd like to address it.
Okay.
So. Again, I don't mean to back up the bus and talk about what I just did, but changes to the Route 9 project, the water system right out here, two changes that have come to me via finding old maps in other rooms. And to be more specific, just recently it was discovered that we should eliminate the 8-inch going through the middle of the intersection and tie into the 12-inch that's in the front lawn of the town hall that crosses Route 9. So in the future, we're out of the intersection. If these guys get into their unidirectional flushing on the valves, they're not out in the middle of the intersection in the middle of the night trying to flush hydrants, turn valves on and off. We can get everything off road. So I started that process with MassDOT because it is their project, and saying, I want to do this change. It's going to be probably even money, maybe even cheaper to do it this way. And the contractor said, yeah, this is great. We don't have to dig through the middle of this intersection in the middle of the day. So as time went on, another map showed up showing a 24-inch sleeve was driven underneath Route 9 out here with the 12-inch AC pipe encased in it. So now I called MassDOT back and said, hold that change. We got to think this through. We got to dig a test pit. We got to verify this sleeve that's out here. Because if that sleeve is out there, I don't think we have to dig up Route 9 at all out here, which is really going to help MassDOT, the contractor, and citizens of Hadley to travel. We'll be mostly off-road in this intersection for the water work. So where we're at now is we have, as David had said, we have a meeting on Tuesday morning with all the utilities over here, and I'm going to talk to MassDOT and I'm going to talk to the contractor, because there is a line item number in the contract with ETNL for test pits. So I'm going to have them dig a test pit on the opposite side of the road and see if this sleeve really does exist. It has ties on a map, but it's a really old map. We're not sure.
How
it's
old?
Old. I think, well, I say really old. I say 76.
74,
76. 74, 76.
Somewhere.
But it's a paper print. It looks like it's 100 years old. So no one, and that, there's the institutional knowledge that I don't think anybody knows if that pipe is there. I think Mike Klamowski reached out to some people from before him, and they don't recall. He said that had been here a year or two, and when 76 rolled through him. Not sure. So we're kind of in a holding pattern on this change. If we can verify that sleeve is there, then I can put a change order together. Now, the question is for MassDOT on Tuesday, are we going to have to involve Bayside to do the official change on the print because it's a MassDOT project? Or are they going to accept me marking up a copy of the print? I don't have the answer to that yet, but we may have to bring Bayside Engineering in to suit MassDOT with an official mocked up plan, you know, off the actual engineering grade computer and all that, so.
Okay, so this is just a heads up, you're not asking for a change order yet?
Not, they, I believe there's going to be a change order, but I just don't know which one yet. So it turned into two, and that's kind of why I backed off or having this meeting. I don't want to change my mind for the third time, so. Hopefully there's no other prints hanging around out there that show up at the office.
In talking to Marlo, after the experience we had in the slow lane of digging up the old line, this line is going to go completely across all four lanes. And if there's a problem and you need to block three lanes in the middle of that intersection, you're just looking for trouble somewhere down the road, or, you know?
Because the 8-inch is getting torn out and being replaced with 12 on the original plan, right south of North, right up the middle of this intersection.
You know, and there's a big drain lane, concrete drain lane going through there that they put through back in the 80s. That's pretty much right next to it, so.
It benefits us in the future, too. Everything's off-road. If we do have a problem and this thing is in a sleeve, we're not going to affect traffic. We're going to be digging off-road.
Who worked on it in the 80s? Wouldn't take off that 24-inch?
Did you put a sleeve on, or did you guys buy a case of beer and said, the heck with it?
What do you think? We're like you?
It's just a question, Mr. Mitchell.
Okay. I just gave you an
answer. So I guess one question I have is, does anybody have any issue with Marlo continuing to at least pursue? And again, money's always, we always have to talk about the monetary aspects, but.
I'd love to have him pursue it.
Yeah, is everybody?
Definitely.
Okay.
I like that too. And let's get this back ordered as soon as we can. I mean, I know we've talked tonight about 35 days out, but let's get it ordered and get it here so we're not, you know, jeopardizing the guys after once this gets done.
With the vote.
Well,
you can order something before a vote.
It's coming. It's coming.
It could be voted out.
I didn't say order it. I said it, get it ready so it's ready to go as soon as the vote goes through and it gets us. Yes.
I will re-verify.
Because last year we got money from stuff that's last year. We still don't have it that year.
I will re-verify the 45-day quote and make sure that's going to be good. But, I think what I'm looking for also is if this, I don't want to hold this project up. I don't, there's another utility that's held this project up. The contractor is getting really, really fidgety to get going on our water work.
Mm-hmm.
So I just want to put out there that if I need to contact Bayside and get them involved, I think we ought to do that and get that done. If they
go
want,
for it.
They want that work done.
Let's do it.
So, but I want to determine what the work is first. We're going to verify that sleeve out there.
That's usually a good idea.
Yeah. I think at the end of the day, it may even be, I'm not going to say it's going to be cheaper. I'm going to say the project even, but.
That's your job.
So.
Okay. So, thank you.
Thank you. Sorry to take up a lot of your time.
It's been a busy 10 weeks, it sounds like, Marlo.
Yeah.
So.
It's been a good 10 weeks, actually. Real good.
After you get done with this town, your hair is going to be all white.
I thought I lost the rest of them last week.
All right. So thanks again for the report. That was
if anybody wants to reach out and get some more facts and figures, there's so much to this maintenance program and everything that it's kind of hard to skim through it for everybody to grasp what it's going to do for us. I mean, I think if you have a lot more information, I don't hesitate to reach out. And
okay, sounds good.
You're going to let everybody know down the garage and then all the departments what's going on, so at least hopefully they'll all be capable of accessing it.
Yeah, well, just real quickly, I don't want to hold up the meeting any longer, but
you are.
The other part of it is, I will buy you a coffee tomorrow morning. The other part of it is who's going to maintain the system when we get it up and running. You can start out where the leader of each crew has an iPad out in the field. You can run it so that just managers have it and are controlling the workload. You give them paper copies of the workload for the day or the work orders. The other expense will probably be two or three tablets or iPads out of the gate. But again, those things will pay for themselves.
Right.
Real quick.
Okay.
So.
It's like having an iPhone type of thing that they're working on.
Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you.
Okay, next,
Thank you.
Next item on the agenda is North Hadley Village Hall. So last week we talked about the proposals for the purchase of North Hadley Village Hall. We talked, I think we had more questions than we had answers on some of these. So David, do you want to?
Well, I think that's basically it, is that we have two proposals in front of us. The price proposals reveal the price of $72,000 offered by Mr. Greenbaum. The board had some questions as to whether the proposal was for the building and property or for the building only. Mr. Greenbaum, I think you've had a conversation with Mr. Paczynski where that has been clarified. So
what's the clarification?
And there might have been a conflict of interest for you to talk to Mr. Greenbaum since you're his neighbor.
I'm not his neighbor.
You abut his property, you abut all of his properties.
I don't abut any of his property.
You abut them.
Where?
In North Hadley.
Where? Tell me where.
Do you live in North Hadley?
Yes, but where do I abut him?
Doesn't he have property
No,
in North Hadley?
He has it, but down the street from me. Well, I don't abut any of his property. He's not my neighbor.
House.
I wish you'd state what you're talking about. Don't make accusations if you don't know what you're talking about.
He has property in North Hadley.
Okay, so
of course I have property in North Hadley.
He does.
He has property all over Hadley.
David, can I have clarification? Is there a conflict here if he's not an abutter?
Direct abutter.
Direct abutter.
I mean, I've not seen a bright red line between the offer that's being made and Mr. Paczynski here. So do you want to tell us the information that you have? And I think if there is a problem, I'll let you know, but right now I'm not throwing a flag on the plate.
Okay.
Joel's right here.
My problem was last week, I'm not going to rubber stamp any recommendation from any committee without having the documents in front of me to study. I got all of the documents for this proposal Monday morning. And look at the documents here, everywhere. How do you expect me to render a decision if I don't have the facts and figures how to do it? So this is what I did. I went out and researched, got all the things, and I try to get the information what is in front of me. I spoke to Mr. Greenbaum. I asked him what his presentation was, and that was it. And so I could understand the proposal better so I could vote in a proper manner this evening.
Okay, so since Mr. Greenbaum is here in the flesh, so one of the questions that came up last week when we were looking at the bids was the issue of building only, building and land,
sure.
Land only, and what degree of flexibility do you have regarding
such? Yeah, sure.
Such?
So in my proposal regarding that question, I said my desire, number four, it says description of the amount of property to be purchased, and I write my desire is site plan number two. And I think site plan number two was giving the land to the town for the easement to Lake Warner, wasn't that right? I tried to be
right, I can see where it says my desire is site plan number two.
Yeah, so site plan number two should be detailed in the RFP.
Mm-hmm.
So I tried to make my proposal as neighborhood friendly as possible.
Okay, so then again, for clarification, the $72,000 is for the North Hadley Town Hall itself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, here's site plan number two.
Yeah, I'm just pulling up the...
Right here.
Okay.
So it's the town hall and the land to the north for parking.
Mm-hmm.
And...
how much land?
I don't know. Whatever you guys have here, I didn't add it up. You know, and minus the land that he wanted as an easement to Lake Warner.
Minus the...
Minus,
okay.
Yeah. So, site plan number two.
Mm-hmm. Does anybody have any questions on that specific question?
What attachment is that under?
It's in the RFP, right?
It's in the RFP, yeah.
It's the...
I think something that everyone has to understand here, this project was moving so rapidly and changes were occurring so quickly, the information that was brought back to this board didn't contain the new information, like Mr. Michkowski's site plan and taking land and keeping it for a future fire station, the recommendation from the planning board, the recommendation from the historical commission endorsing that plan. That's what I'm trying to say. There was numerous changes from the original plan, and this is where the discussion phase had to come in again.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know?
Yeah, that's why we have it on the agenda tonight, Donald, because everybody recognized that there were moving parts here.
Exactly.
Yeah. So...
And really, we didn't have any of this information until Monday. We didn't have it for last meeting.
Right.
We never got it.
We being the Municipal Building Committee?
That's correct.
Right. So I guess the question right now in front of us is, as a board, do we want to take action on the proposals and move to accept, to reject, to rebid, to take further time to evaluate the feasibility of using any of that land up there for a possible town-related purpose?
Would it be within the realm of the process? I guess this is a question for you, David. Can we segregate off the land from his proposal in section 2 and just vote on the building and retain the land for Hadley for future use for a fire complex?
What I think we ought to do is we ought to have a meeting with Mr. Greenbaum, ask that addition, that question that you just posed, recognizing that this will take a little bit of time, ask Mr. Greenbaum if he'll waive the 30-day requirement for us to make a decision, have a meeting, discuss it, if we can come to an agreement, bring that agreement back to the board.
Mm-hmm.
Does that work?
It does. How do you feel about that, Joel?
That's fine.
I'm sorry, Mr. Green. Okay, so you're willing to waive the 30-day requirement?
Sure, yeah, no problem.
Would that allow him to change the price too, or is he fixed at the $72,000? How would that work? Because you're segregating off land, so it would change the price structure naturally, I would think.
Of course it would.
It's flexible.
I think the question is, can we change the scope of the work, and hence would that change the price? I need to check with council as to whether that's
right.
Allowed or not.
Or do you have to do an actual rebid in order to get that new?
Exactly. And
right.
I'm to the point right now is we're looking at the valuation of that property and the two amounts that we have right now. I think we should go out to bid for it and see what else is out there. And firm up that we are interested in keeping the land. Right now, we don't.
I don't see the point. I see the point in keeping the land, but I don't see the point of rebidding on that building that we were in the process of selling. I can understand the land part of it. I'm perfectly good with that, but I don't feel like we need to go out to bid any further on that. I think we may need to negotiate with Mr. Greenbaum on that piece of property in that building, but I don't feel like we need to go out and the committee that set up to sell the building had agreed on Mr. Greenbaum's, that was the charge of our committee, is to open the bids and go with it. And we had accepted his, so I would like to be able to sit down with Mr. Greenbaum and negotiate with you.
I agree with Select Person Chunglo's comments completely.
You know, it's a $400,000 piece of property, and nobody in their right mind, I said it last week, would not sell it.
It's divided, John. It's divided.
I understand that.
That building is not $400,000 worth. it is not worth $400,000, that building.
I understand that, but it's definitely worth more than 72, even with the restrictions on it.
I don't think so, no.
Mr. Devine, do you have any comment you'd like to make at this time?
I think that I would concur with Selectman Chungro and Selectman Pipchinsky, and I think Mr. Greenbaum would like to have the opportunity to sit down and talk to us. I think the historical committee had some concerns regarding the neighborhood and that things, and I think he's addressing most of that, preserving a lot of the green space. I think that's a really good thing for the neighborhood there. I think the buildings committee has weighed in, and I will be with them again on the 17th, but had weighed in that they thought that that Mr. Greenbaum's proposal was exactly the directions we were looking at heading with it, and they had a lot of insight that I got from the buildings committee as to what they felt the cost would be to bring it to a facility that we know Joel keeps up and Mr. Greenbaum keeps up in North Hadley, and so I think that there's a big expense he has with this as well.
Mr. Michikowski?
Yeah, in all fairness to Mr. Greenbaum, he should actually walk into our planning board and find out what he's going to really want to do and what the planning board's going to allow him to do. You know, I mean, not buy it and then tricks later. I don't like that.
Well, you're the one that said last meeting that you could put 10 apartments in there at 55 and over housing, right?
Over 55, not the apartments. I think he's looking to put apartments in there. And I, for one member, would certainly want to work with him because what he would do to that building. And put that. Is that a threat? Okay. But anyways, you know, that was just my comment.
And I think I said it at my last meeting that this is not your first rehab on any old building, correct?
I've never done one this big.
Except the one across the street.
You're up for the challenge.
I also think there should be some contingencies in there to protect us, the town, and also to protect him. If he doesn't get his zoning, he certainly doesn't want the building, because it would be a liability to him. He wouldn't be able to use it in the end. So I would almost think he would request some contingencies to protect him if he doesn't get the zoning.
But you're certainly not leading the witness here, are you?
No, I'm not. I'm just saying, I'm saying the same for us. We have to have these contingencies to protect us that aren't in any of the proposals that I've seen.
Okay, one more comment. And then
yeah, I think everything could be ironed out if he would come into the planning board and said, here's what he would like to do. He could give out a whole list, and we could do that. You can walk in, we could talk about that.
Okay, well, leave that for him and the planning board to work out.
Yeah.
Right.
Did you have a...
It appeared to be a multi-step process. I mean, the RFP, it didn't say anything about zoning. You know, obviously, this building will have to go to planning board or ZBA.
Right. And follow the typical.
Yeah.
The historical.
Because no one knows what's going in there.
So I'm inclined to agree with the majority of the board members here. I mean, I think that that's probably the best way for us to proceed. So, David, that's following your recommendation to... Okay, do we need to take a formal vote on that? Or? Because we're not technically accepting or rejecting, we're...
If you could identify who's going to negotiate, that's sufficient for our records right now.
Identify who
is going to, among the board members, are going to be talking to Mr. Greenbaum.
Yes.
I think Selectman Chungro has the most experience dealing with all this, and I think she should continue on and just bring the information to us when it's completed.
Anybody want to arm wrestle Joyce for this?
Pardon? We'd like Jared to be at that meeting also. That way we can get the information.
Feedback.
From the feedback and have a little more insight as to what's going to happen, seeing as how we are a building committee and we're the last ones to find out about these proposals and stuff. So.
So if it's okay with you, David, the recommendation is to have Joyce be point person for the select board, and Jerry will participate as well.
All right.
Okay.
What was that last word? Jerry is?
Participating as well.
As well.
As
thank
the
point
person Lisa. For the...
Lazy. I'll be the lazy on the board.
Okay. All right. right, so are we good on that, Joel?
Now, would the, would John be involved also? Because he would need to dictate how much land they require.
John?
It was like 40 feet off that line, is that enough for you?
40?
Well,
I might need 50.
David will make sure that you have all the information you need for the negotiations.
According to your plan here, your walkway's probably about 8 or 10 feet, so you have
right,
to bring
the
parking places right up to the building.
Pardon?
Your walkway between the building and your parking lot looks like it's probably going to be 6, 8 feet away, so you'd have to move that closer.
So, David, could you make sure that you do whatever's necessary to get that information to our proposer?
Yep.
Okay.
Absolutely.
There's okay, great.
Too many hypothetical things here. We don't know the actual size of the building. That's something that's going to have to go back to the fire chief to be analyzed. Maybe the proposal that's on the schematic, the building is too big. I don't know. It's like 150 by 50. And if it's sufficient for the lot, that was something he would, so maybe there's extra land that Mr. Greenbaum would be able to have for additional parking. There may be situations where we could share parking between the complex and him. I don't know. These are questions that someone has to look at.
Sure. Well, the other thing I would encourage is if anybody on the select board has specific questions they feel needs to be addressed in that negotiation process, by all means, please funnel those to David as a point, and we'll make sure that they are addressed. Okay.
So,
did you ask for
like
a formal motion?
To ask John if we could, what Randy had planned out for you, or he did the.
The whole thing. This was for the future, not for tomorrow.
Right.
But don't make the same mistake they made at the fire.
You can buy 100.
Let's understand Joel's needs here and what he's got available and what he's willing to deal with, and we'll go from what's left over.
Do you, David, I'm sorry, did you want a formal motion or not?
I don't need a motion for that.
Good, okay. So none will be. Thank you for coming
you.
Tonight.
So how much time do you want to get before we?
No, it doesn't matter to me. I'm in no rush. We'll just all work on it together.
Okay.
All right, so can we do the SAFER grant now, and then we'll go back to the code of conduct, just take this out of order, so that Mr. Spank can able and get some rest?
All right.
Can I make one more comment before we proceed?
Yes.
I would just like to thank Mr. Greenbaum for sitting here 2 hours waiting for us to get to him. I appreciate that, you know, waiting here for us.
Thank you.
Yes, Willie.
Quick question. I mentioned before about some property in the center of town that we got a price on or somebody or three pieces of property.
Some other piece, other people after the bid was open thought that they'd like to possibly put it in the submittal if it was to go out to bid again.
Okay.
Nothing firm.
We'll be talking about that at a later point. Not tonight.
Okay.
I can talk about it at Tuesday's meeting, sir, if you'd like.
I will.
Chief Spankmabel, you have information about the SAFER grant?
You should have, I submitted a letter to David requesting your signature and support of, actually it's kind of a housekeeping item for the SAFER grant that I applied for this year. It's mm-hmm. the federal staffing grant through FEMA and Department of Homeland Security.
Mm-hmm.
This is a extremely competitive grant. This has been on the radar for a number of years now with my goals and objectives, with discussions with the select board, with bringing on Evan Bryant to assist with that process. We spent, I would say, collectively easily over 100 hours working on the grant.
Mm-hmm.
So the final portion of this is providing a letter to the Department of Homeland Security stating that in the event you're lucky enough to receive this award, that you won't fire me and the full-time lieutenant in place of getting that funding. So it's basically saying that you are not going to decrease your staffing as a result of getting funding to increase your staffing.
Right, because mm-hmm. that would negate the whole point of the
correct.
Grant.
Correct.
Okay.
So if we increase it through the funding, at the end of the funding mechanism, if we still keep you and the lieutenant, but decide to not keep the other funded locations, does that tell me that we can't do that?
No, it does not tell you to do that.
Excellent, okay, thank you.
There is some guidance in there, and I provided David with all of that. I believe the recommendation is 1 year after. However, they don't look, part of the grant process is looking at that you're trying to enhance a public safety service and also a homeland security service. So they look at it more favorably because hiring new staff is the lowest on the totem pole for this grant. It's for retention and it's for bringing back folks that have been laid off. So we're already under the gun for, we're low on the totem pole for this to begin with.
Right.
So that's all the guidance in there. You can go online under the FEMA website and you can look up. They have thousands of pages of information.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that's what we're looking for tonight.
So is this a letter that has to be signed by the select board?
Yes.
Yes, I think there's a deadline of this Friday. And just as a technical correction, it's...
Do we have
not that we can't fire the chief, we certainly wouldn't want to do that, but technically we can't lay him off.
Correct.
If the chief does something that we should fire him for, then we can
make it a little bit
easier.
Okay, so do I have a motion?
Make a motion to sign the SAFER grant.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? All in favor of approving the signing of the letter to
Aye.
Support the SAFER grant? Aye.
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 Upstream.
Okay.
Thank you.
Do you want to take it with you, or do you need
sure.
a copy, or what do you want to do?
Before he leaves, could I ask him a question? It sort of pertains to that, and it may help Joyce. Here, regardless if we have a full-time fire department, possibly in the near future, you still adamantly believe we need a substation in North Hadley?
Yeah, I've been asked that. So I've been asked to do risk assessment for the community. In my evaluation, with the limited resources we have right now, and even if we were to obtain full-time staffing in this first phase, which would be daytime, we are always going to be supported by call force members. So a lot of your call force members live in the north end of town. And the study that we did with time frames for response for them, if we bring everything to center, is enormous. So hypothetically, we don't have an ambulance in place, but we have full-time staffing just for fire. They're out on a call, the folks from center, dealing with a car accident, dealing with some other incident. The time it would take for those call force folks to get down to center station to pick up apparatus and go back is extremely concerning for life safety and for property conservation. So my three priorities are a concern.
My point was just to reemphasize how important that piece of land is to the town of Hadley for the future.
There, you came in and discussed it with me. We reviewed the draft that I had put together before the building committee even started on it. And there's, I did a simple drawing on it. I was asked to see what it would look like. And it's certainly not as big as what they have proposed, but they're looking out 50, 100 years, not for something where we just have a place to get vehicles into it today. So they're looking at possibly repurposing it if in the event we decide that it's not feasible to maintain in our station. But certainly, in my opinion, it is critical that we have a station up north. It was designed that way from day one, from before John and I were on the department, and a lot of people, Willie Danlanko included, took a lot of time, probably you, invested a lot of time building that station up.
It's hard to believe the first fire truck in North Hadley was in my barn behind my house. That's what my father provided for the town. And I used to hide in the back when I got in trouble under the flap. That's when I was 8 years old. So I have a lot of experience on fire trucks.
So we'll have a lot more opportunity when you and Mike are in front of us and we have that presentation. I think we're aiming for next Wednesday to bring you and Mike in, if that's going to be possible.
We've been discussing that. We just want to make sure that we're bringing you all the information we can, and we're really inundated right now.
Okay.
On top of the fact that I'm down a full-time person, so I'm double duty right now.
Okay. So,
we
can have
we're doing our best. We're keeping up to date with David on that.
Okay.
Okay, great.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next agenda item, old business, is the code of conduct. So last week, we introduced this, and people were provided with some sample codes from other municipalities. It's a recommendation from the town administrator and myself as well that we adopt a select board code of conduct for the town of Hadley. And with that, now that everybody's had a chance to kind of look at it, digest it, and see what the whole point is, any
I understand the point. I love the Granby one, but I didn't get through it all. So.
It was like 28 pages long.
I know. I love it though.
Yeah.
Well, I think we need one.
Mm-hmm.
Concur.
I agree. We need one too. But there's a lot of fine points in the Princeton one. There's a lot of fine points in the Holden one. I don't know if we can fabricate one that would work for Hadley. Maybe.
You mean like pick and choose from?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, I think David would have the most experience to come up with looking at two or three and what would work best for the town of Hadley.
Mm-hmm.
And if you could do that and then present that to us, I think it would be a lot easier for us to render a vote on it.
That could work.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Everybody good. Agree with that approach?
I don't think, I'm going to state the same thing I stated the last time. I don't think we need it. We're sworn to the people that voted us in. And we don't need to give any more power to the administrator because he works for us anyway.
How are we giving power to the administrator?
Well, I'm just looking at some of the facts and some of these code of conducts where he's just almost like another member of the board, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And the direction that he gives us, you know, is well enough handled.
Well, again,
when it's brought to us.
But it's just written out. It's it's nothing that he's not already doing. And it's nothing more than what he's already doing.
Right.
He's already the contact person for all the people that are under mm-hmm. under our purview. And then he brings it back to us. I mean, I don't feel that that's any more power that he has. I think he answers to us, and that's the way that it is.
Right.
These are pretty in-depth things, John.
Yeah,
I think
know,
if you
I
look
know.
At these and you bring back the next meeting when we discuss it, your concerns specifically, maybe we can find them.
I have not been through the full.
Okay.
I think one word sums it up, and it's courtesy to each other and the public.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. That's what it all amounts
exactly.
to.
Exactly. And we're all doing it right now anyway.
Chain of command, and that's the other thing that we talked about last time you were on the board, Jerry, before.
Mm-hmm.
We did a chain of command with people that were under our purview and who they go to first, and we did it with the police and fire, because that was way out of control at that time.
It happened just again the other day with Joyce, and she was right, you know, and I spoke to Mr. Mason, you spoke to Mr. Mason, she spoke to Mr. Mason, when we had a problem in the other end of town on a Sunday. And instead of six people chirping in some guy's ear, if we have a chain of command and the right person's doing it, you know, if Joyce is in charge and is the liaison to the police department, she's the one we should contact, and she should be on that project, not five different selectmen picking up the phone and calling. And I did it. I'm guilty.
That,
I was absolutely
but
guilty.
But that's going to happen. This is a small town. We just went through it again with the Legion. We've had complaints, and we've all spoke to citizens. It's going to happen.
But we have no liaison to that.
There needs to be a protocol, Jen, and everybody needs to agree on the protocol and adhere to the protocol. And of course, there are going to be exceptions, but the exceptions should be true emergencies. I mean, really true emergencies. So I like the suggestion if, David, if you're willing, if you could put a draft that you think is appropriate for the town of Hadley. Whatever you do, don't give yourself any more authority than anybody thinks you already have. Because I know that there was one in there that was like, you know, the town administrator became king.
Yeah.
So we don't want that one.
Every town administrator is different. Every select board is different. We have to find the right one that works for the town of Hadley. And the whole idea is so that the board of selectmen here can focus in on the work that needs to be decided in a public way, and that you increase your productivity and make things predictable, make things transparent, make things cordial, and that will ultimately spell good results for the townspeople.
Right.
I respectfully request that you also utilize the department heads that you have now to get their feedback too. Because some of the things that we don't know may be occurring. They may have some feedback for you.
You know, when John made the comment like a sixth selectman, he truly is a sixth selectman because he gets the information prior to us getting it. Firsthand, he gets it, and then he presents it to us.
Oh, David.
David does. So he is a sixth selectman, he really is. He doesn't have the voting power, but he has all the knowledge of a selectman before we even get it.
You just said it, Donald. Without all the information in front of you, how can you make a conscious decision and vote on something? And time again, we don't have the information in front of us, and it's stuffed through, and we need to research this stuff a little bit more ourselves before we vote on it. I know I do.
And so we do it, so.
I guess the only way to handle that is requesting more put in our mailbox. If you have a question about anything, that's what I do. I go to Mr. Nixon and say, I want this information and find it and please put it in my mailbox. And that's our responsibility to do that.
And Jennifer will supply you with things that you need also.
She's very good, very good.
She's there for it too, and what she does, yeah. And we thank her for it, thank you. You did a fabulous job, I want to say, on the town book also.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, you did a very nice job in a short period of time, and many comments went out on it, how nice the book came out. Thank you very much.
You're welcome, we're glad to do it. Okay, and then the last agenda item, FY 2016 budgets.
Yes, so I was supposed to have a meeting with the accountant. He had an emergency, and so he changed his time. So if you don't mind, let's skip that for the next meeting.
Sure. I don't think
we'll
mind at all.
Just a quick summary that we're getting towards the end of the fiscal year. There's some budgets that need some support. We have developed an approach for making sure that everything balances at the end of the year. That strategy relies upon cleaning out old articles that have been unused, and so might as well put those to bed. Line item transfers and transfers from the reserve fund.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I just have one item. I actually just meant to mention it when we were doing the code of conduct. I checked with Jessica Spanknebel to find out, you know, everybody's required to do the online ethics training. And I checked with Jessica, as I mentioned at a previous meeting, to find out who's done it and who hasn't. So let's just say that one of us is not a scofflaw. That would be...
I didn't do it this year.
That would be our colleague to our far left.
I've got the past like 6 or 8 years. Yeah, I haven't done this year yet.
No, you're all set. You're done. You're the only one. So you don't need to take it again until 2017.
Okay.
So the rest of us
mine
have to do it.
Just expired last month, and then...
I think I had to do it every... We have to do it every year.
Every 2 years.
Well, it's every two years. So, and just so the process...
For the board, I think highway... I think we've got to do it in DPW every year.
All right, well, what about the rest of
that's
us?
That's what we're told.
In terms of process, I just checked with Jessica today. And so what we need to do is, you can either go directly to mass.gov or just Google it, or you can go to the town website to Jessica's, the town clerk link. And then there's a place in there for municipal employees resources. You just click on that and then it'll just bring you through to the online training.
Actually, I think there's a municipal employees and then elected employees.
County and, yeah,
yeah.
Right.
There's two different tests I had to take, I think.
Please, thank you.
Yeah.
It's like Monopoly. If you don't answer the questions correctly, you go directly into jail.
It flashes at you, just like, no, not so fast. But when you're done, the important thing is you need to print off the certificate that says that you've done and put it on file with Jessica. Okay.
Yeah, you can't email it to her. You need a physical copy.
Physical copy of it. So if everybody could do that, it would be great.
She said it takes about 20 minutes to complete.
Yeah.
About 20 minutes.
Yep.
Okay, so, Mr. Michikowski?
Yeah, I've asked if the board is interested in establishing an ad hoc committee for the North Hadley Fire Station. I certainly would like to serve on that. I think I have an awful lot to offer by what was mistakes were done under previous police and fire complex that I basically opposed from the very start.
and I don't want to see the same thing happen again. I know there's the ex-fire chief may want to be on that, and Spanky certainly wants to put a lot of input in it, and to concentrate only on that subject, nothing else.
Okay.
I know the building committee has, you know, their hands full with all the buildings prepared.
Right, and I think that we're going to, as we're coming up on June, when we're talking about the committee appointments, we had talked about having conversation with the select board about what, again, in the spirit of the strategic plan, what either ad hoc committees or task forces or whatever we want to call them were needed to really dig in on some of these things. So
I think enough has changed that the committee appointments, which every year, admittedly, we've just reappointed people who were willing to serve on the same committee that has the same scope and function. I think we need to look at where we can augment some of these committees, where we have redundancies, where we have an inactive committee. Do we need to continue reappointing this? I mean, that conversation needs to happen.
Okay, so we'll make sure that gets on a future agenda.
I think, too, if we're talking about the building committee, we have to reassess it again.
Mm-hmm.
I think our building inspector and electrical inspector should be remaining neutral and giving that committee advice, not being a direct voter.
Mm-hmm.
We have a conflict, I believe, with David Waskevich being on the library and voting, and Andrew Kopacki is on the Park and Rec in voting. They probably abstain on those issues. I don't know.
The only one I disagree with is Dave Waskevich specifically is the Municipal Building Committee. He was appointed to the library the same way I was appointed to represent the select board as a conduit for information. So I think that's okay.
He's not a trustee of the library.
He's not a trustee.
Yeah.
He's not
okay.
There.
But what I'm getting
to, yeah,
after the transition of town meeting, that committee has lost a lot of faith with the general public. Everything they proposed went down. And so I think there has to be some discussion to see where they're going and what their goals. One thing, their priority list has never been created. And this is what the general public is clamoring for.
Yeah.
What is priority one? And I believe it's safety,
yeah,
and police and fire,
well,
you know, and...
Well, just in fairness to the Municipal Building Committee, they're a creation of this select board. To the extent there's any failure of purpose or failure of, perceived failure of the recommendations not coming out the way people wanted them to, I think the buck stops with us.
Yeah.
So having said that, I do think we've been
in
agreement for a while.
We went on their recommendations, and with the experience that board has, they went in a direction that this board could not even come close to going in.
Mm-hmm.
And it brought out every single aspect of maintenance, building replacement, and the future of Hadley over the next 100 years, really.
Mm-hmm.
And they put it all in one big ball, and they haven't separated it yet, is what they're doing.
And we're at that point,
and
so I think it's time to finalize and
yes,
then redirect the future.
I think what you're saying, what John is saying, is true. But the scope of their project has expanded immensely.
Mm-hmm.
They're doing 3 or 4 different things now.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the original intent what they had originally started for.
We
it's got much
buildings
more
buildings
complex what their responsibilities
okay, but,
are.
But again, the oversight
it's
is all
ours.
Our responsibility.
Yeah.
David,
yeah,
you want to
say? So I always appreciate the people who volunteer to serve on a committee, and sometimes it's a thankless job. Hadley's been around for more than 350 years, and it was always a volunteer organization. The democracy that we're practicing right now is run by the people. You have a few hired guns, such as a chief of police, a town administrator, fire chief, library director, but really the important work, the critical work, the executive functions, financial decisions are being done by volunteers. And so when we approach the committee of reappointments, we should be thankful for all the people who are willing to serve many long hours with no pay, very little thanks, because that's what Hadley is all about. So I appreciate all of them, and I'm sure you all do too.
Yes. Okay, so then, any announcements?
Yes.
Joyce?
Okay. We would like to, the select board would like to extend our condolences to Rose Greavies on the passing of her dad, who was Michael Paradiso. He lived in Belcher Town, so our condolences to Rose. She works in our DPW department. And then to the family of Michael Ian Yuzerski, we send our condolences to them. And to the family of Leo Carney, we send our condolences to them also. We'd like to send out a special thank you. We had all heard at some point after town meeting, Mr. Mish had a large job to do the next morning before school started with putting the cafeteria back together. And the students just seemed to get off the bus and they were going to go to their areas, but they went to the gym, took down everything in the gym, put it back in the cafeteria, and made Jeff's work light that day, and they weren't even asked to do it. They just pitched in and helped him do it. So, you know, again, to our students, thank you very much, and it's just another proof of what our community is, and even down to the students participating in town meeting and helping us afterwards. So thank you. And then for Jessica Spankenable, I didn't do it last week, but we have, with our appointed committee members, people need to go into Jessica and get sworn in for their committees. And I guess there are, as with the other thing, we're in the rear on that. So if people have been appointed to committees this year, then they need to go in and get sworn in by Jessica. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else? If not, do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Good night, everybody.